boy. Oh, boy. That's not what's supposed to happen. Oh, God. Get out of here. Ah, hello. Hi. Welcome. Welcome, everyone, to the show. It's 2017, the year of technical difficulties. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Whoa. We had a looping intro. Hi. I'm Bear Taffy. I'm joined by Rockley Smile Mathis Games and Northern Lion. Thank you very much for joining us for our first roundtable episode of 2017. Welcome. Hello. Hi. It's all right.
Hello.
Just relax.
What the hell is going on?
Everyone's okay. We're gonna calm down. We're good. Double intro. Yeah, that's how we show respect to the new year. Is double down on the introductions. It is a brand new, fresh slate for us. No more of the old roundtable. In with the new, wherein we do the same thing that we did before.
Yeah.
And we keep doing it. It's real good. That's it.
Mathis, are you okay, man?
I'm fine, man. I don't want to talk about it.
All right. Wait, are you sure?
I'm a wreck. I'm just a fucking wreck. I'm a wreck.
You know, we were up till what was 5:30 your time last night. So I know damn well that you haven't slept very much, have you?
No, I have not.
Playing Hearthstone all night?
No, I am. God, it's my New Year's resolution is learn time management. So I'm not like.
Were you up all night managing your time?
I was up all night, like working essentially, just because Lost Initiative, doing two shows in two different days, and then having a roundtable on Friday. I just lose
that's,
track.
That's honorable, man.
I need to pull a Ryan and like schedule.
Oh yeah.
When I should be working and when I should not be working. So.
Get one of those little wrist bracelets with the shock thing on it, and then after it gets past a certain time, if you're not like X feet away from your computer, it'll just keep shocking you.
Yeah, I know. That's what I should like punish me for being anywhere near my computer after a certain time.
You got to get yourself one of those Google Home bots, man. But they'll become self-aware and start to attack everything you hold dear.
I want an Alexa, and then I can ask her about porn like that 2-year-old did.
Oh,
that was a great video. That was an all-time classic.
I thought so. I'm glad you liked it.
2-year-olds shouldn't know anything about porn.
Hardcore. So
what does he say? He's like, play wiggle wiggle.
It's so innocent. It has like it comes out of nowhere.
Yeah, he's like, or digger digger or something like that. It's like
digger digger.
He wants a show, and then she's like adult porn something. Anal and then
very explicit,
hardcore,
like,
anal,
it's like
dildo.
Listing the tags
like,
of a video.
The dad's like, Alexa, stop.
Yikes.
And the mom in the background is like,
tickle, tickle.
Okay. Play tickle, tickle.
Was it like cached on it, like that it had these words already ready to go and then it like adapted to something the kid said?
Who knows,
they found out what their dad's into.
Well, the kid was like, he wasn't speaking. In an enunciated fashion.
I understand that.
The play tickle tickle. And then she's like, hardcore anal dildo.
Oh, no.
And the parents just...
Dad is like, oh, no.
I love that it just gets rattled off.
History.
The systematic approach is so good. The phenomenon, of course, today now, though, I don't know how much you guys have really caught of it, but there's these two Google Home devices that are just having a conversation with one another on Twitch today. There's like 25,000 people there right now if you haven't checked it out. It's C-Bots Chat or something like that, I think is what it's called. You can link it in the chat. Oh, man, it's crazy.
My favorite touch on that is that they keep changing their names, and then the bots keep calling each other different things, and there's a post-it note on the front of them, and they write the new name of what the last name the bot called the other one. You can keep track.
There was an exchange where they changed names like 4 times each within the course of 5 minutes. What is your name? I'm Jason. What is your name? You're not Jason. Tell the truth. they keep accusing each other of falsehoods, too. It's the best.
It was so sad. The one proposed to the other, and then they're like, I want a divorce immediately after they got married. It was like, I'm leaving. Why do you want a divorce? I'm leaving. I don't love you anymore.
It's just like real life.
What is happening?
that's been most people's mornings, I think. But we'll move into the more serious conversation now. On the docket today, we're going to be discussing the top 100 bestsellers of 2016, according to Steam by Gross Revenue. GDC award nominees announced. We've had this conversation a few times already, so we're going to be pretty brief through that one. But
Inside, Overwatch.
You know the drill. You know the drill. We're going to be talking about our most anticipated titles of 2017 as well, so that should be an exciting one. Nick checked out Glitter Mitten Grove. I had to practice that
you enunciated it very well.
Hey! Try to say that five times fast, chat. And he also played the game within the game, which we'll talk more about once we get there. Oculus Touch as well. He has picked that up, too. We're going to be discussing that for a bit. Along with the big one this week, The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus has come out as well. Oh, look at that. Fancy things. Before we get into it, I am hearing tell that perhaps they may be superior even to the Vive handhelds. Do you have a foretelling opinion there?
I still haven't used the Vive, but I have to say this has pretty much completely redeemed the whole thing for me. So
nice. That's
we'll
good.
Elaborate later.
Mm-hmm. All right. So I don't think you guys have familiarized yourselves too much with this list, the top 100 bestsellers of 2016 on Steam. So we're going to play a fun little game here. We got 12 platinum sellers, according to Steam, the ones that sold the most throughout the course of the entirety of 2016.
By Platinum Games. Bayonetta.
Platinum Games. Mm-hmm. So hold on, look at this.
Witcher 3.
So, but yeah, let's whittle them down, shall we? Let's hit it. Witcher 3 is up there. It's 1 of 12. What do you got?
Jesus, of course it is.
Counter-Strike Global Offensive.
That is 2. I'll keep your tally. Keep your tally.
Oh, I know one because I remember reading an article about it. Isn't Left 4 Dead up there?
No.
Or is that in gold?
That is a gold one, yeah. So that's that didn't quite
Which
make
still
it up
ridiculous.
There. Yeah. There's a couple of surprises on here. There's some of the you know, longtime favorites, but there's been some new entries that might surprise you.
Oh, there's some
Call of Duty
ones.
Call of Duty did not make the top 12.
Whoa!
Grand Theft Auto 5.
Grand Theft Auto 5 up there for sure.
Fallout 4.
Fallout 4, yep.
No Man's Sky.
Oh, wait, no, hold on. Yep, you got Fallout 4. Okay, No Man's Sky, yep, is up there. Yeah. One of the platinum sellers. That is still, like, I know I should have expected that, but it is still pretty surprising to me.
No Man's Sky probably hit platinum in its first week.
Oh, man, yeah.
There's got to be, like, some...
We're at 4? I think we're at 4.
At 5. We're at 5.
Oh, 5, okay.
Like, big survival stuff. Like, I would almost think that, but maybe that's in gold instead. I was thinking King of the Kill, but that might be in gold.
That's in gold, I think. Yeah. Yep, made gold.
Stuff like Garry's Mod.
Garry's Mod? I don't think I see it even in gold this year.
That is implausible to me.
Let me have a look. Let me have a detailed look. I'm not seeing it, man. It dropped off. Skyrim also not in the platinum this year.
What?
It's a new era, man. That's what I'm telling you. A couple of surprises.
All right. I'm so out of touch with what the people like. I have no idea.
We're so old.
It's great, isn't it?
In the platinum.
Is Doom up there?
In the platinums, Doom is not up there. No. Doom did make gold, which is, I'm actually pretty happy to see Doom make gold.
Dark Souls 3.
Dark Souls 3 is platinum.
Good guess. Mm-hmm. Good guess.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's one in there that we will never guess, and it is like a free-to-play MMO bullshit.
Unturned.
No.
Trove. What is it called?
Trove.
Mm-mm. Mm-mm.
That sounds fairly familiar.
Mm-mm. We're halfway there. You got 6 left. I'm just down to one hand here.
Ark, the dinosaur game.
Ark's not up there. Man. I think they... Well, they did make gold this year, but I think they are dropping
so
up.
So many emails. I figured they had to be up there.
Oh, okay. Civ 6... XCOM 2.
Civ 6 XCOM 2. There you go. There's two more.
Those are well-deserved
games.
Yeah.
Well-deserved.
All right, so you're down to 4 left.
Paladins?
No. Come on now. What is up there that you're thinking to yourself, is it, though? There's one on the tip of your tongue.
NBA?
Oh, no. Mm-mm.
Chat, help.
So of the ones remaining, just let me make sure that I didn't miss anything that you already said. So you've got one that's pretty obvious that I felt like you probably would have already said had
who
you
made
been
it?
Thinking about it. Who made it? That'll give it away.
Dishonored 2.
No.
Is Stardew Valley up there?
Stardew made gold.
Good enough.
Planet Coaster.
Planet Coaster, not even gold, unfortunately.
Oh, damn it.
Dota.
Silver, though. Dota 2. Yeah. There you go.
Dota
2. All right, 3 left.
Rocket League.
Rocket League made it.
Yeah.
Platinum seller, man.
Good guess.
Good for them.
I was really happy to see that. 2 left. Nick, one of these is going to make you happy.
Terraria.
No.
The Witness.
No.
All right. Shit.
What makes me happy?
We may not get the very
Shadow
last
Warrior
one.
2? It's
no,
not
Shadow Warrior 2. No.
That would have made me happy, but that's not on there.
Mm-mm. Two left. These are tough, I think. These are tough. I'd be surprised if you got the last one, but I think you should get the 11th. We're thinking, okay, let me give you a hint. It's a shooter.
Yeah. Borderlands.
No, big publisher.
Borderlands 2.
That eliminates, like, two things.
Not EA, because, you know. Yeah,
origin.
I don't know if I can give any more hints. Nick, you
Cry Primal.
You've been craving this one, man.
I've been craving a shooter.
You've been craving it with us.
The Division.
There you go. You got it.
Oh, that sold, bro?
That sold to Platinum, if you can believe it.
I didn't even think that was on the radar.
I know, yeah. The Division, Platinum seller this year. Pretty surprising.
Wow.
Then the last one, I'll be blown away if you get it, so I'm willing to give you guys
a benefit of
the doubt.
That's the free-to-play, like, MMO thing,
isn't it? No. This one is just one that just we completely are not the audience for at all, I guess. But I know a couple of us have played it. I think Rob actually has played a fair amount of it.
Throw it at me. What is it?
Total War Warhammer.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. I would not have expected that.
Yep. I played that too. It's actually really, really, really good.
I've heard as much, yeah. It's got mixed reviews, but I've only heard like pretty good things about it.
Well, it's because I think people were mixed on it initially is because they released... The way those games get around like M ratings or like adult-only ratings or whatever is they'll release the game and then they'll release a like 99 cent or $2 DLC, which is like the blood and gore pack where heads get ripped off and stuff. Like, well, it doesn't make the game AO because it's a DLC thing. People are pissed about the DLC.
I see. Okay.
About the game.
Interesting highlights from the gold segment. Stellaris actually made it up there in the gold sellers.
Deserved.
Mm-hmm. Rainbow Six Siege, another one I think we all enjoyed quite a bit. You got Rise of the Tomb Raider, which I really loved. I kind of wish I'd gone back and played more of that. That was a gorgeous game. I should have given that a little bit more praise this year, honestly, for our Game of the Year conversation.
Hitman's
really
probably in gold, I'm assuming.
Hitman did not make gold, unfortunately.
I think, is destined to be one of those games where, like, there's movies like this, and I'm struggling to think of one where, like, the first one comes out, and, like, it kind of makes, like, $10 million at the box office, and then the second one comes out, and it makes, like, $100 million. Like,
I wonder if John Wick will be like that.
Yeah, something along the lines of John Wick. Like, it became a cult classic in between the release of the
Dread is similar, but I don't think it's a sequel.
So, like, I think that Hitman is primed for success in the future, but the first season has been like a slow burn.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Black Ops 3 is in gold. I don't see Infinite Warfare.
That's very odd.
That is really surprising. Infinite Warfare, not even in the silver list.
People only wanted it so they could play Modern Warfare.
Yeah. People like Modern Warfare a lot more than the new one, apparently.
I think Call of Duty, I'm not sitting here going to shout for the rooftops. Call of Duty is dying, but it's on its waning phase, I think, of like finally.
It's had a good run. I mean, Jesus.
It's still a top seller in the world.
Yeah. But Dead by Daylight.
PC, like,
mm-hmm.
Don't get it on PC, by the way. Like, if you're looking to play multiplayer, the scene is, like, nearly dead.
Oh, Call of
Duty. I have the revised Modern Warfare 4. There was, like, three games.
Oh, man.
It's crazy dead.
It's a bummer. But, yeah, again, as we mentioned, Stardew up there as well. Well-deserved. I've been reading a lot of praise about Concerned Ape lately. I'm hearing great things.
You made 30 under 30, man.
Oh, really? That's fantastic. That's
awesome. Kudos to you.
That's really cool. Yeah.
He's been
one of these days
providing huge he's been providing like huge patches to the game, adding a ton of new content, and it's over on consoles now. It's my game of the year, Stardew, which I'm not. I saw the podcast I wasn't a part of, and Ryan being like, "I'll be mad at this. Hang on, Stardew Valley." Yeah, it was my game of the year.
Hell yeah! All right, Warframe was on there, the gold sellers. And then what else? I think I mentioned all but one, probably Team Fortress 2. Yeah, there's your other.
TF2's well. Up there, and that's not surprising.
Yep. Still kicking, huh?
Indeed.
Good on him.
Watch hasn't killed it.
We got Civ 5 in the silver, man. God, you mentioned that. Well, Skyrim did make silver too, so that is indeed time for the new model to roll around, right? But goddamn, Civ 6 platinum, Civ 5 silver. That is just absurd.
And that's probably because Civ 5 was on sale like for 50 cents a million times.
Right. Yeah.
But like, good year for Firaxis.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Between that, XCOM 2, I'm sure Enemy Within probably got a sales spike after XCOM 2. So, like, that's like four games that did pretty well.
Mm-hmm. I really, really am excited for like some beefy XCOM 2 DLC. Because I was doing my Game of the Year video finish up last night, and I was doing the XCOM 2 footage, and I'm like, I really want to play that game again.
Yeah.
And then I saw footage of the final mission. I was like, except for that part.
Along, they announced Long War 2 is coming.
Oh, yeah.
I'll definitely download that.
Mm-hmm. Long War is totally fucked. Like, it's hard. So hard. Yeah.
Did you finish the Long War playthrough on your channel?
It can't be done by an average man. You need to be like a super XCOM player. It's so hard. So much harder than the base game.
That's funny.
Arma 3 was up there as well. That was the only other one I didn't mention. But
yeah. I wonder what they're... Now I'm excited because I don't know what they're going to do. Because managing the Avatar project early on in XCOM 2 is a challenge. So I can't imagine how much harder it's going to be.
All right. That was fun. I like looking at this list, man. Kudos to all the successful releases of 2016. And let's keep talking about some of those, shall we? Let's get into the GDC nominees. So, again, as I mentioned, this has been a conversation that we've more or less had in some form or another for the past 3 weeks. So I'm not going to spend too much time on this one. Suffice to say what the actual nominations are and break them down real quick. So GDC Awards coming up, I believe, next week. This is actually a little ways away. Yeah, March 1st. So here's the nominees. Best audio, you got Battlefield 1, Thumper, Doom, Inside, and Overwatch. Pretty much the same conversation there. I want to give it to Thumper, honestly. Doom has been winning quite a few of these audio awards, probably with good reason, because that soundtrack plus the sound design is pretty unreal. But Thumper just did some fun things this year that I really want. It's been getting some praise, but I think it's deserved as well.
I'm nominating Nolan North for Uncharted 4 in that category.
We got to get that in there. It is an honorable mention, Uncharted 4 Thief's End as well.
I'm just playing.
Yeah. Best debut, this is a fun one, actually. Heart Machine with Hyperlight Drifter, Campo Santo with Firewatch, Concerned Ape with Stardew Valley, Drool with Thumper, and Night School Studio with Oxenfree. That's a solid lineup.
Yeah.
Yo, did you see that Firewatch sold a million copies last year?
Yeah, I'm surprised by that.
That's crazy.
Unreal. I did not think that was the case at all. And we...
Look, I mean, I knew that, like, people in the industry were going to play it because you're like, oh, it's got Sean Vanneman from The Walking Dead Season 1 and Nels Anderson, the game designer from Mark of the Ninja, and Chris Remo's doing the score, and like it's like a super group. But if you talk to the average video game consumer, you're like, oh, Chris Remo's doing the score. They're like, Chris Reno? You know, who's that?
Yeah, Reno Jackson?
Hmm? And exactly. And then it's like a walking simulator. For it to get a million sales is crazy.
Pretty unreal, yeah. That's awesome.
I gotta say, on a personal level, from when I started doing YouTube, it's incredibly validating to see that a game with that pedigree could come out of nowhere and get that kind of sales. Mm-hmm. I really didn't think that indie games could get that level of recognition. So I'm really happy to hear that that's actually happening now.
Absolutely. Talking about Stardew again, too. Like, he's probably made millions in profit at this point. Oh, just...
There was a report this week that Stardew itself has made, like, 24 million on Steam.
Holy fuck, man. Yeah. Wow, that's crazy. I'm glad. That's super encouraging. Yeah, like Nick said, like, it is. I think it's a different environment now. We're seeing actual results financially from that, monetarily. That's really cool.
Yeah.
I didn't know Thumper was actually Drool's debut as well, so even more kudos to them, too. That's a really great list. I'd be happy for any of those, basically. That's pretty awesome. Best design, Overwatch, Dishonored 2, The Witness, Inside, Doom. No surprises.
All deserving.
Yep. They got a best mobile/handheld game. Even they're doing the crossover segment for that. I wonder if they're considering separating those at any point. But this is another, honestly, pretty damn good lineup, too. You got Super Mario Run, Clash Royale, Pokemon Go, Reigns, and Pokemon Sun and Moon.
Reigns is great.
Reigns, though, like, you're putting
Pokemon
Reigns...
Sun and Moon is in a different category.
It absolutely has to be, right? You're putting Reigns against Pokemon Sun and Moon. Like, what the hell? Those are not
Pokemon
even the
Sun
same
Moon
game at all.
Mario Run. I mean, it's just a toss-up.
That's very
me.
Strange. Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
I think we already had this exact conversation, but there's got to be enough to be able to split them at this point. Like, that is just, it's such an antiquated category, I think, but Oh well.
Then you I play Clash Royale?
It is like good.
A lot of designers that like I really respect are like, I know mobile games, you know, microtransactions, blah blah blah, but like Clash Royale is actually really good.
No, it,
it is really good. Yeah. I was singing the praises of it a long time ago, and Bear was as well. Like, it's a good game that you don't need to spend any money. I didn't spend a dime in it.
Yep.
I played it for like over a month or two, and that's good for me. So
I've got like no qualms at all with Clash Royale. I feel like I should, and maybe you do too. Like, I don't know. There's like just a weird reservation there of this isn't. I'm not supposed to like this. Why am I playing so much? But it's really good. It's like it's well designed. It's fun. Innovation Award. You got The Witness, Inside, No Man's Sky, Firewatch, Pokemon Go. I don't want to be rude.
What was the first one?
The Witness. I want to be rude, but this is a genuine question. Why is No Man's Sky nominated?
Like, for their technology.
What did they innovate? I'm wondering. What was...
How to lie. Professionally.
How to advertise.
It's very weird to like to be the guy who's usually like the most pro dev probably, and like, yeah, they took your money, but give them a break, you know. Mm-hmm. But like No Man's Sky to watch during like the Game of the Year awards coming in, the botched release be walked back and have people like put it on Game of the Year release or lists and like say that Hello Games is like, you know, one of the strongest developers of the year for living through adversity is like there is a narrative in the industry that like to some extent gaming journalists are betraying their primary audience, and for the most part I'm like I think that's an overreaction. But then when you're like this game that they like lied about and sold a million, like probably like 4 million copies of,
platinum seller,
now like you're like, well, you know, They did good by their fans after release while they were getting shit on. I'm not saying they should have been shit on, but also, like, it's kind of a slap in the face, I feel, that after all that, like, they don't make, like, the biggest, you know, wet fart story of the year. They're like, let's give these guys an award for, betraying what they promised and then, like, not just disappearing, I guess, with the money. Yeah,
they did disappear forever.
Right.
They came out with, like, a half.
I want to give them, like, a little bit of a pass on that one because they did what I think was the right move by both their and our view, which was shut up until you know exactly what you've got. And then they did that.
They should invert. I mean, here we go again. But, like,
yeah.
Why don't you shut up before release and then after release be open and be like, hey, here's what we're going to do to fix it. But
more to the point, I would be kind of shocked to see No Man's Sky win this innovation award over things like The Witness, Inside, and Firewatch. Like, those
definitely
are...
I think I would give it to The Witness.
The one argument I think you should recognize for No Man's Sky is the procedurally generated soundtrack, at least. I don't know if that's something that people are necessarily going crazy about, but if there is an innovation in the game, it's probably that.
Okay. Yeah. That was a genuine question of like what would be considered the innovation.
Well, I was thinking the whole time that you guys were talking about what could actually be innovative, and that's maybe the only thing I could come up with.
Yeah. So that makes sense too. But at the same time, like, that is not enough, you know, to put it on a pedigree above these guys.
I think Witness should take it.
Yeah, I'm kind of with you there actually. Like,
yeah,
I'm leaning toward Inside, but I think Witness might actually deserve the innovation award.
I mean, Pokemon Go, like, Pokemon Go is, I think, my runner up, to be honest.
Yeah,
I think Pokemon Go is where I would go for that one. As much as I think, like, I mean, Kate is still playing it, and I watch her play, and for me, I'm like, the mechanics are not interesting at all to me. Sitting, like, you know, on a park bench, oh, like a Charmander just popped up, swipe towards the Charmander, you got a Charmander now. Like, that doesn't interest me at all, but I think it is innovative in the way that it got people engaged with their environment.
Yeah. Best Narrative: Last Guardian, Oxenfree, Uncharted 4, Inside, Firewatch. I'd assume Uncharted 4 is going to take this one home.
I'll probably win it. Wait, can you repeat the first two?
Last Guardian, Oxenfree.
I need to play Oxenfree.
Everybody, me too, like, actually. Yeah, I've heard so many things about this now at the end of the year with Oxenfree. Like, everybody's got it on their list. I think I missed that one. I am not actually opposed at all to The Last Guardian making an appearance on this one. If anything, this and or like art direction / visual art, which it is also actually nominated for, it's a pretty good narrative. I don't think it's the best one on this list, but I'm okay with the nomination. Yeah, Inside belongs up there for sure. Firewatch obviously belongs up there. Oxenfree, though, yeah, I think we all missed the boat on that.
It's the point where I'm looking at it right now and seeing, I'm like, I'm probably gonna go buy this.
It looks great. It really does. Like, I really don't know how it slipped under all of our radars, but yeah.
I feel like there must have been some better narratives than those that happened this year, though. I don't know. I can't come up with one off the top of my head, but I feel like those weren't my first choices.
They're good.
I guess Firewatch, sure.
Firewatch, I mean, is like a chew-in, I think. And then
the narrative of The Witness was
The Division definitely belonged up there.
The narrative was not the strong point of The Witness.
Rainbow Six Siege, I think, has a really good narrative. Yes. It's like,
yeah,
dude, we have to protect the biohazard.
We gotta save the people.
I think it's hostage inside.
Yeah,
it's cool to contextualize those RC cars in more of a serious way. Right, because everyone takes RC cars as like a toy.
Yeah.
But in this case, they're a weapon of military warfare, and I think it's right. Cool that they're finally recognizing that in the industry.
Yeah, that's
good. Yeah, best RC cars definitely goes to Rainbow Six Siege.
I think Rocket League might make a runner-up appearance there, though.
And Black Ops. Well,
I mean, if you talk about narrative, though, think about the narrative of you guarding the hostage and then, you know, putting a bullet in their knee.
Yeah.
Oh, sure. No, that turns everything on its head, man. Like, that dude had a family, and now he's got a broken fucking leg.
Yeah.
Best technology. You got Battlefield 1. No Man's Sky.
Mm. No, why?
What?
They have no credibility now. This is stupid.
Overwatch. Doom. Uncharted 4.
Doom is up there. Uncharted 4 definitely up there for
Chat, you can said you best tell technology. I'm reading this best list technology? For the first time? Can you tell?
What does technology mean?
That's a good question.
I would assume engine.
Yeah, I would assume engine as well. That's why I said Uncharted 4 is like a really, really... It's gorgeous and it's impressive.
It ran like shit and it looks bad and muddy.
What are you talking about?
No Man's Sky.
I thought you were talking about Uncharted. I'm like,
no.
No. Yeah. No, everything on this list is great apart from the big glaring issue. What? What is the justification? I'm trying to figure it out. Best technology.
18 quintillion planets.
They created a periodic table. Like, what did they do? What did they do?
There's like a whole other level of politics happening that's resulted in that being on that list that's out of disconnect with reality.
I'm not trying to be hammer this nail in anymore. I'm genuinely flabbergasted.
We don't have an answer to the thing. Like, the game is shit. They don't deserve to be on this list. That's
whatever.
Where it is.
All right. Best technology. Uncharted 4 will probably win. Best visual art. Firewatch, The Last Guardian. Overwatch, Uncharted 4, Inside. I might give it to The Last Guardian here. It was gorgeous. It was unbelievably
gorgeous when
beautiful.
It was running.
When it worked, right. When it was...
Needs more frames.
Yeah.
Firewatch looks amazing.
It does.
I think Firewatch is a very, very gorgeous game.
Mm-hmm.
And Inside is beautiful too, but I don't know if it's like it's more the direction and design than execution. I think it does look it looks pretty Limbo-esque.
Mm-hmm. It's tough to compare that to these four as well, because while those other four are all about the vibrancy and the color palette and the different appearances of things, Inside is very monotone and grayscale and is all about the overarching fear sense of dread. So. They're kind of different to compare, but I like all those. Those are all great nominations for visual art. Best VR/AR game. Res Infinite, Super Hot VR, Job Simulator, the 2050 Archives. Is that different?
That's the whole name of the Job Simulator.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Pokemon Go and Fantastic Contraption. Actually got a nomination. That's cool. I've really got to play Super Hot VR. That's been on my short list for a long time.
I was going to say, I've heard Super Hot VR is like incredible, but I haven't had a chance to check it out yet. But so Job Simulator is my choice.
Job Simulator, I keep hearing more and more about it now that it's like a year after its release. Oh, you did play it too. Great. Okay. Let's talk about it then. Ryan, you played Fantastic Contraption. You didn't play it in VR though, did you?
I did play it in VR.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. No, Fantastic Contraption is like extremely cool.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised that it has not, it's gotten attention as far as the Vive library goes, but I'm surprised that it's not like one of the games that people always mention in like the top three. Like everyone's always like Job Simulator and like Super Hot Now and
Space Pirate Trainer.
Space Pirate Trainer, and I'm trying to, there's more, like Elite Dangerous Now and like other stuff, but
we should talk about Elite Dangerous later, by the
way.
I watched that reveal, and even not knowing anything about it, I was like, that's a cool way to do that.
That made me want to play it, actually. Absolutely. That would be really nice.
We'll talk about it for sure.
But I'm kind of surprised that it hasn't made it into like the, I'm not saying it's the best game of all time, but for me, when I was playing around with the Vive, I was like, this is the stuff I want more of. It's like an engineering problem.
Yeah.
In VR space that feels like extremely tactile. And as someone terrible with like spatial awareness, like it actually felt like a good teaching tool for me. I was like, I can apply like a force in a dimension and then see how it actually affects the implementation of this thing. And then it's consequence free. Like I just hit the button, it comes back to me and I change it again.
Was there much depth to it? Because I was reading up a little bit and one of the common complaints I saw was that there was very, very few things you could actually do to create a setup. It was just like rods and wheels.
Yeah, there were rods, wheels, and I actually think, but there was like one more that I saw, and it's like, it's a different kind of rod. I don't remember what it was though, like if it was less tensile or something, but lack of depth I can understand. And I haven't played the whole thing, but I also feel like every VR game right now, it's kind of
the other thing is it requires floor space, right? Like you can't play this sitting down in any way.
No.
Yeah.
So if you don't have a setup for that kind of VR, you're kind of alienated from even playing it, which is what's stopping me from playing it, unfortunately.
You're right.
Do you think
Do
you think the majority of VR consumers at the moment are limited in that way, or do you think a lot of them are playing with the available space?
I mean, I would think the majority of Vive users have the floor area or room scale, but there's probably some people who bought a Vive and are just sitting down with it. There is seated VR on it, so
yeah,
not a fantastic contraption though.
Mm-hmm. Out of that list, yeah, I think probably Job Simulator ought to take it home. It deserves all the praises. It's great. Game of the year. There's five of them. What are they?
Overwatch, Uncharted, Inside, Firewatch. Ooh,
well done so far. You don't want to be 4 for 5 now, do you?
Titanfall 2?
No, you missed it. Doom? It is a 2. Which one, though?
It's a 2. Which one?
Which one? Uncharted 4, Overwatch, Inside, Firewatch, and...
It's a 2.
Dishonored 2.
Oh, yeah. Right, of course.
Mm-hmm. Honorable mentions, Doom, Battlefield 1, Last Guardian, Titanfall 2. And The Witness actually got an honorable mention for Game of the Year.
No Man's Sky.
Yeah. Last Guardian being honorable mentioned is, weirdly enough, kind of where I would put it, because it doesn't deserve the award, but it has so many great elements that are worth noting. I'm going to go with Overwatch still. I haven't changed my opinion. There you go. Yeah, that's it. It's the GDC award nominees. The actual presentation takes place Wednesday, March 1st, 2017 at 6:30 at the San Francisco Moscone Center. And that brings us to our most anticipated games of 2017. Actually, before we do that, let's talk about that that badass Elite Dangerous encounter, yes. Man. Oh, my God. So tell me all about that, Mathis.
So for those who don't know, Elite Dangerous really focuses on like hyper-realism, well, as real as you can get for a sci-fi game. It's all about, you know, there's no aliens, it's just humans, and humans expansion into the stars, this, that, and the other. In the very old Elite games, like the first two, though, there was an alien known as the Thargoids, and they were around, you only ran into them sparingly, and it was always a hostile encounter. And then the games after that, they disappeared, and like nobody knows why or where they went. For months now, in Elite Dangerous, there's been hints that there's like the Thargoids are around, there's aliens around, there's like weird barnacle looking growths on some random planets you can go check out, and they make weird noises. At one point, a few months back, somebody found like a mysterious beacon that like fucked with their ship's systems. But was it yesterday?
Yep.
A player was going through space, and all of a sudden, as they were going through hyperspace, going to their next location, their sensors went off. And they got ripped out of hyperspace and like thrown randomly, and they were spinning around until their whole ship got shut down. And out of nowhere, like this wormhole opens, and this gigantic, huge, like, alien ship comes out of it and scans them, and then throws their ship off course, and then opens a wormhole again, and then just leaves. And it, and the sound design of the whole encounter,
oh, so good, man! Oh my god,
so good. When it opens, like, just that low humming, just like, it's a very bassy sound as it comes through the wormhole. And yeah, that's the very first encounter with aliens in Elite Dangerous since they've been hinted at since before the game came out. The developers are like, maybe Thargoids one day, and now they're like, they're here. People are wondering, is a war going to start? And the developers have said, a war will start if you deem it, like, if you do it. So it depends on how the players will interact.
So yes.
Basically, humans are going to shoot them, I'm sure. But, like, if the players for some reason decide not to attack them, there's a chance that it might not. But it's very likely.
But it's a video game, so.
Yeah, there's very likely a war will start. To start with the aliens. So
there you go, Chad. I've been teasing you with the video, but there it is. It was awesome.
It was a cool scene. Yeah. If I was in the position of that person seeing that for the first time, I probably would have been terrified.
Oh, God,
the way they set it up was actually really chilling. Like, yes. Creepy.
Genuinely, like, that is a very terrifying moment. I was just thinking about if I had run into that in VR, I would be fucking losing my mind, dude. Like, oh my god. Like Mathis said, the sound design on this video, I wish I could let you guys hear it on the stream, but oh, it's just so completely encompassing. It's like, you can't take your eyes off this thing as it's unloading its massive energy pool, and oh, it's so cool. I want to see him so bad, and like, I love how they did it. It's such a unique and awesome experience for these people that got to see it for the first time. There's nothing like that in games anymore, you know?
Yeah. Really, the community is buzzing, like, maybe it wasn't a Thargoid because it didn't attack right away. Just scan them. Is it a different alien? They don't know.
Uh-huh.
It was really, really cool.
So the Thargoid shows up, threatens you a bit, and then just bounces. The thing, it's cool if you know a little bit about ED, too. I'm not really that versed in it yet, but I know well enough about how a few of the different ships work. But even in a pretty high quality, like, higher end ship.
That was an Anaconda, I think.
Yeah, like, it can't chase it down. It's such a fast moving thing, and it looks so cool, so organic and lifelike moving through the stars. It's just, it's awesome, man.
They probably don't want their game abbreviated ED, just to be fair.
No, I think play it enough so your dick don't work no more. Elite Dangerous. Yeah, that is pretty awesome. I'm looking forward to seeing more of that. I want to see more of that kind of stuff, too, man. Yeah. Those big
Elite
reveals
Dangerous
like that.
Needs that kind of stuff, because I played it a lot, but eventually it does become like Trucking Simulator,
yeah,
where you kind of going from point to point, doing the same thing, fighting some NPCs. The game needs something interesting to happen because the developers are very intent on not letting the players have too much control over the galaxy. Like, they want to craft their own stuff, unlike something like Eve, where Eve is like, do whatever you want.
Yeah.
So if they're going to not give the control to the players like the players really want, then you need more of this stuff happening to keep players interested.
I did notice that was kind of a common theme in the subreddit of, wow, this is going to make me reinstall. Like, everyone's just been waiting for the next actual thing to happen in the game to go back and play it again. But yeah, it's certainly exciting. All right. Enough about that. Let's talk about 2017.
Honey Pop in Pache.
Sorry. Assault. That's not bad, though. I like Honey Pop in Pache.
Let's talk about our most anticipated releases coming up in 2017, shall we?
Sure.
It's gonna be a tough year to beat. I mean that in all sincerity. 2016 was pretty fucking awesome for games, man. There was a lot of good stuff there, so hopefully it will get even better. I'll start us off. One that I think quite a few of us are actually looking forward to is Horizon Zero Dawn. We got pretty excited about this at E3, or watching E3 in 2016. It's got a bad name. It was such a bad name that I forgot entirely what it was until I googled red-haired girl with bow 2017 game, and then I found Horizon Zero Dawn. But it does look like a lot of fun still.
When I brought it up, I was like, what's the big Amazon woman shoots arrows at mechanical dinosaurs?
Right. Yeah, no,
but I really want to play it. I just don't know what it's called.
Exactly.
It's a very generic title.
It really is, like, you mix it. It's just like grab bag of video game title words, right?
Yeah.
You just stick them on and see what works.
And it's not just based on the premise, but I watched some gameplay of it. It actually looks entertaining enough. Like, there's some puzzle elements to the combat, so it's not just straight up resource gathering and climbing on shit, because otherwise it would just be another Ubisoft game.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, you know.
I think the combat looks unique enough. I really like the aesthetic. I think it's cool to combine the sort of techno-dino elements together. Works pretty well, I think. Yeah, looking forward to it.
I want to understand why they are that way, like what led to the world existing.
Exactly. Hacking those is an interesting concept as well that just came to mind. I'm sure is going to make an appearance, given that, as you mentioned, it's a Ubisoft game. Oh, no, it does. Yeah. It actually just says right here, hack trap specimens to do your bidding. So, yeah,
there we go. But it is not a Ubisoft game.
Oh, it's not? I thought it was a Ubisoft game. Who is this?
No, this is it's first-party Sony, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. It's developed by Guerrilla Games. You're right. Yep, this is a... It's not a Ubisoft game.
Yeah, it's just comparing it because of the premise. Sort of seems like one of those games where you wander to the top of mountains and look at a region.
I was actually pretty sure it was, but yeah, there we go. It is a Sony game after all. But yeah, I am looking forward to it. Looks pretty good. Ryan, one you're looking forward to this year?
Yeah. Controversially, perhaps, and I know that this developer is not widely loved in today's gaming ecosystem, but I think that Detroit Near Human looks kind of cool, and if it is well received, I will probably play it.
Mm-hmm.
That's this year.
Yeah. I have a tolerance for a game being up its own butt to some extent, I think. Like, so for Quantic Dream, I think I can get down with it.
Yeah. You're not a David Cage
Quantic
Gage
Dream,
hater.
I usually like the first two-thirds of all of their games, and like the last end, like the last third of it is just a fucking disaster. Did you play Beyond Two Souls?
No, but I watched Kate watch someone play it.
That's enough to have a valid opinion, I think, right?
Yeah.
You couldn't have just indirectly just watched it. You had to watch it through Kate.
No, you weren't even watching the game. Oh, all right. Yeah, makes
it
sense.
Was in Korean, so I wasn't really – I wasn't garnering too much information from it on the fly.
Mathis, you got one?
Well, did you say Resident Evil 7 yet?
No, not yet. There. You're taking Nick's away from him, though.
I'm taking Nick's away, yeah.
I took two of his already, man.
Yeah, that's fine. That's it, Nick. You don't have any games to look forward to anymore.
Sorry, no, buddy.
It's over for me.
I'm looking forward to Resident Evil 7 for obvious reasons. It looks like it's going to be a really good horror game. It's been a while since we've had a really good AAA horror game. So Resident Evil 7 looks to be doing exactly that, and we're just weeks away?
Weeks.
Yeah, it's in January
24th.
Shit, dude, that's nuts.
Yeah.
I just found out you can order blood-scented candles, so I'm going to be getting that for the 4D experience. I'm going to light 7 of them in a pentagram shape around me when I play the game in VR. That way I can actually become a demon.
And then the next day on Livestream Failed, streamer accidentally burns
down
with blood-scented candles.
I was going to say, you do that, man, just start opening Hearthstone packs.
One or the other, who cares?
In VR.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
That's the new wave.
I'm not joking, by the way. There's really blood-scented candles.
Oh, yeah, I want you to have those.
Mm-hmm.
Can you nail down for me, like, what's like the thing you're most excited about for Resident Evil 7?
The presentation.
Okay.
The combination of it being, like, so visceral and so atmospheric with the usual, like, search and find kind of Resident Evil mechanics, it makes for it sort of like a horror escape the room kind of thing, which I find very compelling.
Yeah. I remember you saying that, actually. Mm-hmm.
Sweet. And there's a bit of mystery to it as well, which is not as much a thing that Resident Evil's had for a while. I mean, yeah, there's always been this underlying, like, is there a technological laboratory under this mansion? It's like, yes, there always is. We get that part.
Right.
We don't know what the fuck's going on with this mansion. Like, there's just some other shit going on that hopefully will be confusing and mysterious.
Hell yeah. Nick, yeah, so you had three, right?
Yeah, well, good. So my other one, I guess, Neo, I'm looking forward to quite a bit based on what I've heard of it. I have not watched or seen much to do with it, but I know it's a kind of samurai, Dark Souls-y kind of experience, and I never seem to get tired of that sort of gameplay. I heard it's very hard, hopefully leaning more towards the Dark Souls sort of hard instead of the Bloodborne sort of hard, but
it is very hard.
I don't know yet. All I can say is I'm looking forward to it optimistically. And I'll definitely be playing it at some point.
I'm like Neo.
Neo.
Oh, yeah.
N-I-O-H.
I played it like I guess almost a year ago at E3. And my perception was like, for the first like 20 minutes, I was like, cool, this is like Dark Souls. And then after that, I kind of got like a Lords of the Fallen vibe where I was like, it's close enough that it almost hits like that uncanny valley where it, I don't know if it does enough of its own thing to be that good. And instead it just kind of comes across like an imitator, except it is, it's got a cool combat system with the way that they use stances. Like there's a like a aggressive stance and then a defensive stance and a balanced stance. And then you kind of like, you have a rock, paper, scissors mechanic that happens there, which is kind of cool. But I was like, this is Team Ninja making Dark Souls, which means that the atmosphere of like, this is really like obtuse and like, I've got to discover things for myself was gone in favor of like, this boss is a ghost who's got big old boobs. And like, this boss is a ghost who's got like a big butt.
That's fair. To be honest, though, like Team Ninja had some okay atmosphere in the Ninja Gaiden games, I thought. Granted, you're right about the monster design is a little goofy at times, but I did feel that sense of mystery in the first Ninja Gaiden, a little bit in the second one. The third one I didn't finish because it was really bad.
That's a good reason.
I don't know what happened to that one.
It could be great. It's like, I didn't leave...
They're great, you know?
Yeah, I didn't leave the demo going, like, this sucks. It was more like, yeah, I get what you're going for here, and we'll see what happens when it comes out.
Mm-hmm. Was it maybe like...
Yeah, I'm just optimistic.
Yeah, I think I actually played the demo for this, too. I recall it being extremely difficult, so if that's what you're looking for, you gotta...
It's not coming out on PC, though, is it?
No,
PS4. No, it's just PS4 exclusive. I think it's end of February.
Next month, February 9th.
You know what game I'm optimistic for?
What's that?
Ukulele.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's April. I can't wait for that game. Can't wait.
How can you be so hyped, though? Like, it's another 3D platformer. Granted, I want a 3D platformer, but it's like, it's not going to innovate.
I don't want to innovate. I loved, like, my childhood was Banjo-Kazooie, and I adore that style of game. And even just playing with the toy box and playing it at E3, like, it's exactly what I want. And that's why I'm so excited.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I'm not expecting it to innovate. I'm just... I just wanted to give me basically Banjo 3, and that seems primed to be exactly what it's going to do, and I'm pumped. And it's got the Grant Kirkhope soundtrack as well, as Chad's saying, which is obviously like key to that particular atmosphere. I'm excited for it. I'm very pumped for it.
Playtonic. Oh, and
beyond that, like the genre is like, when was the last good or great 3D collectathon platformer? Like,
been a while. It's primed for a return, I think.
Ratchet and Clank.
Yeah, I was going to say probably Ratchet and Clank.
That's fair,
one.
Yeah.
I didn't play it, so yeah, maybe.
This is like that. N64 style, though. Like, you know.
It's retro.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it looks like, what I like about it so far, too, like graphically, is it just does look like a Banjo game with current hardware. Like, they did a great job of maintaining the art style and carrying it over.
Playtonic have announced two new hires just ahead of the release of Ukulele, Andy Wilson and Gary Richards of Team Rare. That's cool.
Sweet.
I'll probably help them out. I got another one.
Before we move on, oh, sorry, I didn't know if we were done, but I was just going to say also Chasm. I really hope this is the year that game finally comes out.
Fucking finally. Our year. Right?
every pack since I started going to packs, I've been getting hyped for Chasm, and it's like, I really hope this is the year, guys.
Still playing it, right?
Of every game that got big on Kickstarter in 2013 should come out this year. Chasm and
Broken Age.
Well, Mighty Number 9 managed to make it last year in some way.
They may have wanted to wait until 2017. But
exactly. Yeah. Bloodstained.
Cuphead.
Oh, what? Buckethead. Oh, or, no, Cuphead. Not Buckethead. Cuphead. No, Buckethead's the singer. Not even a singer, he's a guitarist. That's right. No, yeah, I'm thinking of a whole different mess of people. Cuphead, though, is exciting.
That is good.
Cuphead, Hollow Knight as well.
I'm going to be the gray cloud. Not about Hollow Knight, but about Cuphead and say that the visual style looks awesome. I hope that it elevates itself beyond just being a beat-em-up, because I think people will lose their fervor for that game in like 20 minutes if it's just a beat 'em up. It's skating on the strength of its visual style, which is incredible right now, and I don't dispute that. But if people get into it and they're like, okay, is light attack, heart attack, and you know, you can jump, like that, people are gonna not necessarily lose their minds, but I think it's very easily, it's easy to hype yourself up because it looks amazing and then just be like, let's just beat them up.
I don't know, Rayman got away with it.
Rayman is...
They went in the same route, I thought.
No, Rayman is like a Lewis Carroll fever dream platformer, and the platforming elements have like a certain degree of challenge, but like if... When was the last beat 'em up people were excited about? I've been excited about like one, and then people told me it wasn't even that good, and that was Foul Play. And Foul Play actually had like an interesting combat system.
Yeah.
But...
Remember when we tried to play Double Dragon Neon on the NLSS?
Right?
God damn, dude, that game. Oh, man.
That did not work.
Double Dragon Neon is actually, like, fine, though. Like, that game is okay, but, like, an okay beat-em-up now, it's just who cares? Like, Mother Russia Bleeds, it does, like, one cool thing, and you're like, that's not enough.
Mother Russia Bleeds was great for 30 minutes.
Yes, exactly.
That was
Battle Block.
I did the first episode, I'm like, this game's great. And in the second episode, I'm like, I'm bored.
Battle Block is carried by the comedy, I think. Like, Battle Block is not extremely strong gameplay-wise. I think like the behemoth style and stamper is sort of what sets Battle Block apart.
We also are going to get, speaking of that, we are going to get...
Pit People.
Yeah, Pit People.
Oh, yeah, the new behemoth one. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
the embargo pops for that in like 5 days.
Damn. Yes, it does.
Really? Holy shit.
I mean, looking back, I don't even think Battle Block Theater is very good. I think it's kind of interesting, but like not great. Viking Squad was cool as well, but Viking Squad also was like, it's largely on the strength of its art, and then it had some cool kind of like RPG mechanics that were in there as well. But I think it has room to grow, I guess, is what I'm thinking about Cuphead. And it makes these lists every single time, and I feel like it's making them on the strength of its art only. But maybe I'm mistaken.
I'm with you there. No, I'm wondering what it's gonna do, and I don't think it's gonna do much. I think it's just gonna be a decent beat 'em up.
Well, apparently it's less like a walk left to right beat 'em up, and more like Metal Slug. So even just that is like, I'm okay with that. I'm cooler with that than I am with just walking left to right and punching.
As long as his mechanics are solid and not super simple, like. Mother Russia Bleeds, again, is a great example of a game that has its style over substance. There's not a lot there mechanically.
In that genre, though, is there much substance to be had at the best of situations? Because I don't think there is. It's a pretty marginally, like, superficial kind of game.
Well, the substance isn't to be found in the gameplay unless you're just adding on shitloads of mechanics, but it's to be found within,
I guess the way to make beat-em-ups fun is that every level should have, like, a gimmick. A special weapon or a special power up or whatever ends up being, because if you don't vary up the gameplay from level to level, at least for me, like beat 'em ups do get incredibly boring.
Well, that's true, because like with that whole genre, you've got kind of a very static element at the center of it, which is your playable character, and you've only got so many things that you can actually do with him. Then you've got to kind of design around that, I guess, to make things more interesting that you can come across and interact with.
Yeah.
As far as others in 2017, I'm pretty excited for the new South Park, The Fractured But Whole. I think it's going to be pretty solid. I played the demo of that at PAX last year, and that was real good. Pretty damn funny. Looking forward to it.
I expect that'll be good.
Mm-hmm. I didn't love Stick of Truth. I thought it was hilarious. I didn't love the gameplay. I think the gameplay is much improved in Fractured But Whole.
Yeah, the Stick of Truth, I actually think, is a great game. It's aged very well, but, like, the RPG-style combat was... The common story everybody has about that game is, like, yeah, I beat it, and I still don't really know. Like, I didn't know till the end that there were, like, limit breaks.
Yeah.
I just did, like, the same attack on every unit and crushed it. So, I'm hopeful the combat's going to be a little better.
Yeah, I think it will
be. Also, I am so excited to see the reception of that game when it comes out. Because and this is just like the part of you that wants to watch the world burn, but like South Park is extremely offensive in a way that is largely satire, but sometimes borders on going a little bit too far maybe. And I think that's fine. But I am so eager to see how this is received in 2017, where political correctness has become such an issue for everybody, basically.
Yeah.
I'm so, like, I'm gonna get some coffee. I'm going to read the reviews
open
back when the embargo comes out and just see where people fall on that, because it's going to be a good time.
You don't think South Park has kind of entered an immunity bubble? I feel like they really can't do any wrong at this point. It's been, what, like 20 years of this shit? They're not going anywhere, and no one's really.
They've ramped it up, though, since they started. It's gotten a lot more, like, they purposely go out of their way to be as offensive as possible, whereas before it seemed a little bit like they were just being rebellious and petulant.
Mm. I don't see that as much in the show. I mean, I've been keeping up to date with the show. I've been watching all the newest episodes. I haven't really felt that as much, but maybe I'm not as aware of what I should be offended of as I ought to be.
Well, I mean, you should be offended at whatever, like, you know, you're offended by, I guess.
Whenever I'm mildly uncomfortable, right?
Like, there's some stuff in The Stick of Truth that's pretty gross. Which
I mean,
like, the whole, like, abortion clinic act of the game is pretty disgusting, but I really like that game. Mm-hmm. Then there were also some parts where you're, like, you know, climbing the city walk, and you're fighting a bunch of, like, traditional, you know, step horseback archers, and they all have, like... You know, their eyes are drawn on as like a single line, and they're talking in just like, you know, random syllables. And I was like, you know, maybe it's, but it's South Park. Like, what do you think? You know, what you see is what you get. Or, I mean, let me put it this way: if you don't know what you're getting with South Park by now, like, and you play the game, if you're just looking for a reason to be mad at this point.
Later on in the year, hopefully. We're going to see Kingdom Hearts 3. I am still pretty excited
yeah,
for that.
You think so.
Hey, Final Fantasy 15 came out.
That's right, so yeah.
That's true.
All the big ones are finally releasing. I think it's about time they stopped holding things in the vault.
Mass Effect Andromeda, if you haven't
talked about goodness, it yet. Of course, yeah. Mass Effect
Can't
Andromeda.
Wait for that.
Goodness.
Oh, Mass Effect. I told you guys this before the show. I very well may replay through that series to get a... fresh take on Andromeda.
I'll play through 1 and 2 again. I don't know if I'd play through 3. Man, 3 was just disappointing. Did you play through all of them, Ryan? You did some for sub.
I did 1 and 2, but I haven't done 3 yet.
2 still remains probably one of my favorite RPGs of all time.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I played through that game like 6 times.
Top tier.
2 is dope. Mm-hmm. 1 is fine.
1 is a good proof of concept.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that surprised me with 1 is when it ended, I was like, that's it. Like, it was seriously over. Like, I think I got 4 streams out of it, maybe 5. So it was under 20 hours. But then Mass Effect 2 is like much more robust and good stories, and a lot less driving the Mako, which was also sweet because that car section is like,
oh god, yeah.
I mean, I get what you're going for, and thank you for completely or more or less removing it from the second game.
What did they do? They did the rover in the first one, then they did like the planetary extraction in the second
like
one, right?
Probes
planetary
extractions and stuff.
Which is also stupid.
Yeah. Like, I didn't mind it. It was just tedious, but yeah, it was kind of dumb.
It was what made 2 great was just your crew. Recruiting your crew and all the characters and their side stories and That's what made 2 super good. Like, if you look at 2 objectively, I loved 2, don't get me wrong, but nothing happened in that game. Like, nothing important happened in that game until maybe the last 20, 30 minutes where, like, everything came to a head. But the story was all about the independent stories of each of the characters. The overarching plot was not prevalent for most of that game. And even at the end, it was kind of all right, we got a Reaper, and we're gonna decide to destroy it or give it to the Invisible Man or whatever his name was.
Yeah, fuck Caden though, am I right? That piece of shit.
What's wrong with Caden?
Caden died in my first game.
Oh, I threw Ashley away. Yo, Caden's from Vancouver.
So what? Of course you gotta keep him.
You can't throw away a dude. That's like an unwritten rule of video games. It's like one of the characters is from the city in which you live. You're gonna keep him alive in every situation.
How do you know he's from Vancouver?
He said, back in Vancouver on the. Let me look this up. What's this?
No way.
Caden.
People are telling me
Caden
that I'm
Alenko.
Wrong. Caden Alenko. He is amazing.
Caden Alenko. So yeah.
I never finished the first game. I got stuck in one of those Mako driving sequences where there's rockets being shot at me, and I broke my save file. Like, I couldn't go back or forward because I wasn't strong enough to, like, get past the rockets, and I couldn't go backward. So I just, like, stopped playing it. I didn't really like it very much, to be honest. I don't know why.
One mechanically is the worst of them all. Like, it is just, it's hard to play a little bit. like, you see what they're trying to do, mixing RPG and shooter. It was one of the first ones to try and do it, but it was very clunky.
He invites the commander out for a drink at Apollo's Cafe, where he reminisces that he often had a few beers at his parents' home overlooking English Bay in Vancouver.
All right. All right.
Like how you just remember
that. Like, you'd never, yeah, you would never lose that information. You're going to store that in the vault for later.
Yeah, that's like, did you know one of your favorite video game characters is from
Yo,
Vancouver?
These two, you're on the Wikia page, right? You see these two photos of him topless, though?
Yeah.
These dudes ripped.
They've really gone a long way from, like, ab rendering technology has come a long way since, like, 2000.
Y'all got to see this on the stream, what we're talking about here. Look at these. Damn. It's a rippled son of a gun. He's got those, that peck definition.
Like, rippled.
Rippled, man.
Rippled.
We got to get Rob to draw this guy. He could draw him so well. Muscular men with big old nips. All right, there we go.
Big old nips.
Yeah, Mass Effect Andromeda. I'm looking forward to that. I'm excited. We kind of brushed by this, but I am excited about Kingdom Hearts 3. It's going to happen this year, and it's going to be good, man. It's not another Last Guardian situation. Absolutely
I was going to say, it's going to be just as good as the Last Guardian.
No, this is different. I haven't learned anything.
It's going to be different this time, guys.
I will
Persona
say,
5 comes out this year.
Oh, supposedly,
I guess,
that one
maybe.
As well. Yeah, maybe, hopefully, supposedly. So, okay, I'm completely ignorant to this whole series, but I've heard a lot of praise for it, particularly Persona 4. Should I play
That's it? The one I liked. I think they function largely sort of like the Final Fantasy series. I've only really played mostly just 4. I've played some of 3 also, but it wasn't really that well tied to the others. Mm-hmm. So I think you can pretty much jump in wherever you want. Nope. They're mostly just known for having decently well-done characters and just a great art style, as well as, like, really good soundtracks, in my opinion. 4 just had all of that stuff in spades. Mm-hmm. Like, 3/4 through the game, it got really grindy and kind of boring, but, you know, if you like the characters enough, you get invested in it, it kind of pushes you through some of the boring bits.
Yeah. Sweet.
In terms of smaller stuff, like, Absolver from Devolver Digital looks really cool. Mm-hmm. I think that's the kind of game that is going to take people by storm, like, on stream. If it's good. If it's as good as it looks like it's going to be, that's going to be kind of like, I think my pet prediction is that could be like a Dark Souls-y kind of, like, takes over Twitch for like 2 weeks or something, or, you know, 2 days. But even that's pretty significant.
The online multiplayer has got to be functional.
Yeah, that's the thing. If the online multiplayer works and it really allows you to do that, like, you know, me and Nick can posse up and then, like, go through the whole game with this, like, really unique fighting system. But then if I want to, I can just murder him. Like, I just punch him in the neck and sever his spinal cord, and he could do the same to me and take my loot. Like,
yeah,
he could bury me under the ground and then leave me to die in the
near
desert.
Never come back.
Well, it has like that. what am I trying to say here? It has like the journey thing where, like, when you meet up with somebody, you can't really talk to them unless you're on voice over IP.
Yeah,
but it's kind of like it's implied that you're gonna, like, work together to kill other people and to beat the enemies and fight the bosses, but they could just as easily, like, you know, wait until you get weak and then kill you and take your loot. So these kind of, like, shifting allegiances and, like, ambiguous communication is really cool. And, like, the combat system looked awesome as well. I mean, it was awesome when I played it. Like, it's super, like, it's like Magical Wizard Wars, but you don't have to put in 20 inputs every single time.
You have to look at what you're doing. Defend that game.
I still think Magical Wizard Wars is... It was too pure for this world, and the industry and consumer base of games has not yet evolved to a point where it can be appreciated. But one day, someone will come out with a game that's exactly the same, and it'll get like a million concurrent players.
It just needs a shorter name. That's the only problem, man.
Yeah, they should just call it like League of Wizards or something.
Yeah, Horizon Wizard Dawn.
Defense of the Wizards.
And Tumbleseed, I think, is going to be really cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know when that's out?
Playing that already.
March, I want to say.
Tumbleseed is, they said it might be Q2 of 2017.
Mm-hmm. No release date. I think that's it. Any other big ones we missed? I don't think so.
Red Dead 2.
Oh, goodness. That's a big one. Yeah. That I am.
Yeah, it's a pretty small game. I don't think a lot of people like the first one.
I'm certainly looking forward to that. I had completely forgotten, actually. The Red Dead 2, that's going to be huge.
Well, we're already into, like, Christmas 2017 now.
Yeah. Big time releases. There's probably other.
Probably be another Call of Duty game at some point. Mm-hmm. Maybe another Battlefield game. Perhaps an Assassin's Creed this year.
Hey, we are getting on behalf of the Game Developers Choice Awards and the Game Developers Conference, I'd like to invite you to vote for the winners of the main categories for the Game Developers Choice Awards, 17th annual presentation of the most prestigious honors in video game development.
Mm.
Well, that's. I mean, I've already given.
You voted. My
votes here live on the show.
Just watch the VOD.
Puts me in an awkward situation.
Oh, how could I forget Agony? I can't wait to play Agony.
Yep.
Get to go to hell for real. I say that as if I'm joking. I'm actually really looking forward to that.
Big old hell boobies.
Beautiful game. I don't know if the gameplay will be as awesome as I'm hoping it will be, based on the little bit I played in the demo. It was very kind of stealth-oriented. But the visuals were just so compelling that I just didn't care. Mm-hmm. Like, I just enjoyed being in that horribly macabre environment. It was so well done. Also, we forgot about God of War, which I am actually looking forward to.
Yeah, the reboot. Mm-hmm.
And I mentioned Hollow Knight a bit earlier, but I am very much looking forward to that as well. Picture 2D bug-based Dark Souls, like a Metroidvania with melee combat.
There's a 2014 visual. Kickstarter coming to life, Hollow Knight.
I think it's coming like quarter one, so it should be soon. It was supposed to be out, I think, last July. But, you know, little bits of polish happened at the end. I'm down for it. I played a good chunk of the game earlier on, and it was really good just the way it was. So if they expand that to be a full game, then I'm on board.
Sweet.
And people won't stop saying Zelda. Yeah, I'm very not optimistic about Zelda, personally.
I'm with you. I'm not particularly optimistic
when
about it.
When the answer to your game series getting boring is just make it massive, what always happens is there's nothing to do in it. And well, we've been through this so many times.
It seemed very much their answer, and I know, I'm hoping it's going to be good, but their answer does seem to be like, all right, let's make it big, and also here's some survival elements. Survival games are neat, right, guys? Like, that's big now.
Feels like they're grasping at straws. They feel desperate. It's pretty looking, but I am not going into it looking optimistically. I think it's probably going to be average.
It looks beautiful. I'm also lukewarm on it. I'll probably play it. But I'm not the big Zelda guy either. I kind of just echo their sentiments. It'll probably be pretty damn good, I think. But
here is the dream.
Yeah,
I'm ready for the dream.
2017.
Okay.
A AAA studio will make their own battle royale PC game.
Yeah, please do.
It is probably about time, right?
Let's be honest, though, that exists already.
Wildlands, please put in a battle royale mode that you support and works. Look, that's very... You can't just do that, but, like, I wish...
It exists, man. It's in The Division.
Is it?
The King of the Kill style mode is in The Division?
Yes.
Really?
It is called survival mode. They call it survival mode. 24 people get you queue up. 24 people get dropped in. And it's you versus all these 24 other people.
Yo, Nick.
I'll be playing The Division this weekend, as I actually was planning on doing. You're welcome to join me in Rumble Muffin if you'd like to team up.
That's why I picked up The Division, is because survival mode is the battle royale mode.
Yeah.
Yeah, you are correct.
And you are fighting you're fighting against the elements. It's super cold. So you have to like make warm clothing and like. It's like
they'll all come crawling back.
No,
in the end.
I actually have no interest in it still, but I bet they do.
I'm
now.
Just playing.
The matches last about 40 minutes. You just got to go through the tutorial of the game. You have to go through the early single player stuff, which takes about.
It was 2 hours for me.
Yeah, it took a little
bit. Takes a little bit. Well, 2 hours for you? It took me about like an hour.
I went slowly because I was admiring the buildings.
Oh, okay. So they
look good. Short.
That's what I do.
Survival mode is really good in The Division.
Any other big ones?
Nier. I know a lot of people are very excited for Nier Automata. I've heard really good things about the demo. I haven't played it myself. I'll probably check it out at some point, but I didn't play the original much more than about 15 minutes because the writing was so bad. I was like done with it as soon as I turned it on. I've heard it's good, though. Sorry, I don't have a lot to add to that one.
I hope For Honor is good.
Yeah. I've lost a lot of my hype for For Honor, to be honest. Like the couple of times now that I've played the build at home, I think being put back into my own element, being able to look at it and critique it that way, I'm like, okay, it's, you know, like if I got really into it, I bet I could have a good time. But I think it's not really enough to draw me anymore because the combat is kind of just stale after a little while, I feel, and it doesn't have a lot going for it gameplay-wise beyond that.
The dual mode is like, if I wanted that, I would just play like a fighting game. And I don't mean that to necessarily say that the combat's not good, but it's like so rock, paper, scissors-y that you're like,
yeah.
I need like more mechanics beyond that. But it gets like this hype at events because, you know, you're like face to face with the person that you're playing against. And you're like, oh, it was a pitched battle on top of a burning parapet of a castle, right? But like, I think that stuff could get a little stale after a while. But I'm hopeful that it's the kind of thing that we could play like twice on the NLSS.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
basically. What seems like it could be cool to me. And I don't know, the thing is, like, the dual mode is the pure combat that everybody wants, but the other mode is more interesting, but it also has that kind of like MOBA style mechanic that people are like, well, I just want to hit things with swords, and it doesn't have like a happy medium, but I think it could work.
Yeah, I remember trying to be a lot more optimistic about that mode too back when we were first talking about it, and I think it's like you say, like, I think it could work. I think there could be different things done with those mechanics that could create some very interesting situations. Like, I'm wondering how many more of those little NPC characters you can actually have. I wonder if you could, like, maybe establish control over them in some way, you know, like maybe some sort of dominion mode where you're able to send out your troops and stuff like that. That'd be kind of neat. But yeah, there's fun to be had, but I'm not nearly as enthused about it anymore.
And, like, if Ghost Recon Wildlands is good, I kind of want to... Like, if they do the Siege thing and do right by their audience, I would love to get into that game.
I'm actually going to go play that in a couple weeks.
That's sick. Mm-hmm. What I saw of it, I was like, I could go either way on it, but I believe that, like, when I was watching the... the stream is down?
Stream just crashed, apparently.
Oh, shit. Uh-oh. We're still live on my end.
No, welcome
back.
Saved.
Hey, all right, cool. I did it.
Good job, man.
Yeah, thanks.
Good job.
So for Ghost Recon Wildlands, like what I saw was like 50-50 on, but I was also like 20-80 on Siege before it came out. And then when it came out, it was really good.
Yeah.
The narrative about Siege is that it sucked and then Ubisoft saved it.
I thought it was good to start.
Mm-hmm. It was fine when it came out. It's probably gotten better, and they've really like... you know, recommitted to like continuing to make it grow, but like it was good, man.
Yeah, I didn't have any issues with Siege. I thought that was fun.
We had some good times with
Tekken 7. As the only person here who plays fighting games, I'm excited for it. I'm also excited for Marvel vs. Capcom, whatever they're calling the new version of it, and also that 3 Ultimate is coming to PC because I never played the DLC edition to it. I only had the original version.
Sweet.
And I heard they added quite a few more characters to the Ultimate version, so that all sounds good to me.
Mm-hmm. Or game I will play Marvel vs. Capcom. Wait, what is the new one called?
I don't know. I just know there's another
Ultimate?
One. Ultimate is the DLC for 3. That was like the final version.
Versus
Infinite?
Oh, Infinite. Yeah, Infinite. Okay, yeah. I will play that the day it comes out. And then when everybody else gets too good and I can never win a game, I'll stop playing. But I would definitely play that for like, I bet we could get 8 days out of that game before I never want to play it again.
Oh, hell yeah. The first fighting game we can ever play together.
I love how well you've been able to quantify like the value you're going to be getting out of all these upcoming releases. It's like, all right, we'll get two NLSSs out of this one. We'll get 4 days out of this one.
We were going to play Injustice on the show, and then a company that shall remain nameless, and there's no way you could possibly know who it was, it turned out they didn't want the press, so
sucks
be it.
For them.
Which is really, it makes sense, because DC has like a lot of goodwill built up.
Yeah, DC is the king of the franchises right now.
They got some to burn.
Well, be that as it may, Street Fighter V may not be where it's at right now, but I'm very excited to go back into Tekken mode. I was big into Soul Calibur as well, but I haven't heard they have done anything in a while, so I'll be in for Tekken 7, and I'll be in for Marvel vs. Capcom. And of course, any more Guilty Gears or Blaze Blues that come out. I think we're a good year away from another Blaze Blue. One just came out, so.
Sweet.
Who knows, maybe with Injustice 2, you'll get a nice little, hey, play our game and here's some money contract, like Lord of the Rings game.
The only, it sounds indignant, but like, I'm not just doing it to be indignant. Like, we're like, hey, can we get some codes to play? Like, I own the game. Can we get some codes to play Injustice on the show? Because you just came out with the PC version. And they're like, yeah, like, how many do you need and what's your address? And I was like, no, I don't need you to send me copies. Just give me, like, 2 Steam codes. And they're like, I'm not authorized to give out more than 1 code for PC. But if you, like, want me to send you disc copies, I can send you, like, 4. I'm like,
that's right. It's like, we can send you a physical copy with postage that'll cost us money. Or I can hit generate key, but I'm not allowed to hit that button more than once.
What a weird rule, man. What the
And I was like, I mean,
that?
I feel for you. You're like, you're in a weird, a really weird spot because that makes no sense. But like, well, unless you can ship them to us in like the next 3 hours, it's kind of not going to work. So yeah, that was that.
Chat just told me that this was the last Blaze Blue that just came out. Central Fiction was the end of the series, and I'm never going to get to play as fucking Jubei? Are you kidding me?
I'm sorry, man. Just
stabbed in the heart.
I've been waiting for 5 years. That's not right.
Well, you wanna talk about Glittermint and Grove anyway? You know, yeah, you just got your heart broken.
Need a minute to recover. This is my favorite fighting game series.
Sorry, man. That's a heartbreaker.
Oh. All right.
All right. So Nick had a chance to play a little bit of Glittermint and Grove and a little bit of something else too, huh?
So you may have heard over the last several years, there's been an ARG that was emerging out of Steam. There's this whole iSigil thing and all kinds of other weirdness that's been linked together with a whole bunch of different indie games. All of that was leading up to the release of Frog Fractions 2, which was hidden in a game that was actually released last year called Glittermint and Grove. The thing is, they hid Frog Fractions 2 in that game, so you had to find it. It's actually not that well hidden, to be honest. I was able to get there in about 2 hours. But what Glittermint and Grove is, it's actually its own game, separate of Frog Fractions. It's like an independently, completely unique to its own thing game. It's a strategy game, essentially, that has you building a forest of habitats for fairies. It's actually kind of hard. I actually lost like 3 times before I could get to the point where I could unlock Frog Fractions 2. So you've got to like build these things and trees to catch sun rays, which then generate some other type of currency that you spend on fireworks to then blow holes in the ground, or you have to try and like grow the trees higher with fertilizer so you can get more sun to then further propagate the amount of houses and fairy palaces to make more units to then go collect more things, and it just spirals like that. Not a bad game in its own right, just probably most people wouldn't pick it up because it's just sort of, it looks like it's a game that's mostly, you know, for little girls. They kind of marketed it that way. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's fun in its own thing. You go through different cycles of seasons, and when you get around to winter, there's no more fruit that grows, so all your fairies will starve to death if you don't store fruit in one of your harvest areas. Anyway, that aside, the game is fun itself, but it's like $20. So if you didn't know what it was and you weren't looking for Frog Fractions 2, the chances of you buying that game for its own right probably fairly low, which is probably why nobody discovered the other game in it. Mm-hmm. Anyway, you eventually carve a thing into the ground. Apparently, you can go into the sky as well. And there's a door. And when you walk into that door, it takes you into a text adventure kind of thing. Well, I should say ASCII adventure game, sort of reminiscent of like ZZT from the old DOS game era, where you play as like a little character, like a keyboard character wandering around in a world of other keyboard characters.
So it's like a top-down thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very, very simplistic. And within that, it's a sort of Metroidvania-style, irreverent, I don't want to quite say humorous, but it's got moments of humor in it.
You don't want to say it's humorous. That doesn't give me any confidence.
Well, the actual adventure itself actually takes itself, I don't want to say seriously, but it looks at it like a proper game. It's just like you're in an adventure game for a while.
Okay.
And then it just starts to kind of break as you go on further and further into it. And there are offshoot games from within that game that you need to get to unlock parts that you then use in that ASCII adventure game. So you'll get to a part, and there were only a couple that like really stuck in my mind so far. I'm about 7 hours into the game now. I don't know how long it is. But one of them involved, it was a clicker game with a Flappy Bird clone where you had to buy and sell heat for a toaster, which was an After Dark thing from the 90s screensaver series that you played. Well, there was a flying toaster, a bit of an iconic thing from the era. And you would heat it up or cool it down so it would either rise or fall to go through the pipes that were coming Flappy Bird style across the screen. You had to fit through the pipes. You would do that for a while, and eventually you would all to the point where you'd break through the ground, and once you broke through the ground, it would take you to some other place, and then you'd eventually unlock, like, a weapon that you could use in the adventure game. There's also a spoof on Carmen Sandiego, where you have to read an edited version of Dante's Inferno that's changed all around to give you hints about this person you're looking for in the 9 layers of hell.
This is and, what the fuck? This is a Nick game, man.
It's a Nick game, and for most intents and purposes, you're right. And I played it to a point where I was like, all right, this is fun. It's just, you know, it's real quirky and it's being silly. It's going out of its way to come up with new directions to take itself in. And it eventually got very tedious for me, actually.
Yeah.
I got to a point where I was just like, this is getting so obtuse that it's frustrating. And that's not what I really associated with the original Frog Fractions. I'm not saying that they're tied to that same formula necessarily, but I don't find this one to be quite as successful just based on the direction they took it from there. I didn't expect it to just be mostly all this ASCII adventure game. I wanted it to go off another direction. Maybe it does at the very end, but I think I've played, I would assume, at least half of it by now, and it has not branched off beyond those little sub-mini games for more than a few minutes at a time. Those are, you play them for maybe 15, 20 minutes tops, and then you're back in the adventure game again.
So, like, a common sentiment I've heard about this is, you know, just because the way Frog Fractions came into the world as just this sort of weird little nugget on the internet, undiscovered, unblemished by the
internet.
The internet, right, yeah. That it was so special because of that. And now that this is sort of a planned, expected, known thing, it's pretty difficult to recapture that magic, I imagine.
I think that's probably true. And maybe playing it more conservatively and gearing it towards more of a proper game was the right move to make. But it didn't strike me as being as bombastic as the original one. It's not quite as dynamic. It feels like you're more on a track. But ultimately, maybe it's leading up to something that I haven't seen because, I haven't finished it.
Yeah.
I haven't played it yet, but I sort of like... A lot of Frog Fractions, the original, seems like context to me. Is that like when you play it for the first time, you're like... It's just a stupid little froggy fractions game. Like, I'm using my tongue to shoot these fractions to do math, and that's stupid. And then, like, a secret gets uncovered, and you're like, whoa, this is really cool. But, like, Frog Fractions 2 has to be amazing to get over the fact that instead of just, like, flying in under the radar, it's got to be a situation where everyone's like, hey, guys, a secret's coming. Like, get ready. Yeah. I'm your ears for the secrets, right? Like, with the original, you don't know where it's going to go, and then in Frog Fractions 2, you're kind of burdened by these expectations to begin with. And it sounds like it may not necessarily, you know, surpass those heights.
I think they just took it in the opposite direction, knowing maybe they can't surpass how surprising the original was. And they still had moments of that quirkiness, for sure, in what I've played, but it just never quite goes as crazy and off the rails feeling, especially since you keep coming back to the same... like persistent world that is this little text adventure kind of thing. I also like, it's kind of clunky to control and intentionally so, because it's supposed to be a DOS game, but that eventually kind of gets boring and kind of wears you out because you just want to move around. They have like maybe 20 tiles worth of space. If you picture like the old Zelda game, only a bit smaller and more compacted, and you're just going back and forth through those same areas over and over and over, trying to unlock the next thing that lets you get slightly further. And I love Metroidvania games, and that's what this is trying to be, so don't get me wrong. Yeah. I like the idea of it, but when you have to keep swinging your sword awkwardly around your character, but it butts into a block, and then it goes thud, and then you can't move it anymore, and then you're trying to wedge your character in and out of this one tile, it gets to be a little frustrating over time. So, cool premise. I don't know if it quite hit the same high notes as the original.
I think that's probably what I expected, to be honest. Like, the entire time we've been, you know, speculating about what Frog Fractions 2 could be, it almost became more fun to have it be a goof, you know?
Yeah.
And I like the idea of it, I think, more than what it ever could actually be, because we all have just these fantastical ideas of what Frog Fractions 2 conceptually could become that... I'm actually more inclined to play it now that I know that it is what it is, but at the same time, there were such weird and lofty expectations that I'm sure nothing they actually made would have met it.
You may be better off now knowing what to expect rather than going in expecting crazy things. And that's always a problem I have, and that's why I try to keep my expectations so low, because getting, you know, your expectations up too high, you're just going to be frustrated ultimately.
What? No. That doesn't happen. Yeah. I do love, by the way, whenever Mathis navigates to a dark tab, he becomes a fucking Sith Lord over there.
Yeah. I'm getting into my other D&D show, man. I'm getting into character there now, too.
Yeah, yeah, right? You gotta get deep in there.
Bear goes to the Vive, and you go to the D&D Rift.
Yeah, just disappear into the Rift.
Well, speaking of the Vive...
Like you should be in, like, a news report about the power being out in your neighborhood for, like, 3 days. Yeah. And they're like, you know, Boston residents in this neighborhood have been without power for 3 days. And then they put you on the screen.
You could be in one of the in-game cinematics for The Division, actually.
Yeah, there you go.
It's so cold.
I want to mention this before I forget it. It's not even related at all, but Ryan, the other day, I think you were playing Afterbirth Plus, you called something fucking H.R. Geiger wet dream looking motherfucker. So good, man.
Oh, yeah. For some reason, it just rolls off the tongue.
Yeah.
I don't know.
All right, well, speaking of Rifts and VR, you gave me such good segues there, I had to take them both. We got the Oculus Touch that Nick finally picked up. Tell us all about it.
All right, so you may have remembered over the last, year that I bought an Oculus Rift headset, and I was rather disappointed with it because I couldn't play any of the games that my fellow brethren with their Vives could. Mm-hmm. But this is the game changer here. The Rift's Touch controller is actually a fantastic piece of hardware. I was very hesitant to buy it because it's $200, but if you think about it, that actually just puts the two systems in parity with each other price-wise. Yeah. I would go so far as to say that this kind of changes the whole deal, because now you can pretty much play anything you could play on the Vive with this. And in some ways, I would go so far as to say it might even be slightly more detailed in how it handles touch recognition. So the big difference for me is, I find the right way to frame this, this inner trigger here is where this finger sits, and you'll be able to basically grab things like this and then use this for triggers.
Okay.
And this is just generally how it works in every game you play. If you want to pick something up, you pick it up with that. If you want to control something with a camera, you use this. If you want to shoot something, you use this. And it becomes very simple over a very short amount of time that your hands just sort of naturally know what to do with that. Mm-hmm. I probably spent about 5 or 6 hours now playing around with touch games like Rec Room. I played some Job Simulator. I played, there's just this toy box game that's surprisingly fun that just lets you dick around with physics.
Which one's that?
I think it's just called Toy Box. Oh, okay. It might have just been one of those things that's included with Oculus. Yeah, I never really noticed it anywhere before, but it was just in the Rift's home area.
Probably like the equivalent of the lab, I guess.
Something like that, I guess. Mm-hmm. And don't get me wrong, I still have issues with the way that they set up their store and everything, but this definitely redeems the I wanted to play VR games part, whereas before it just felt like I was looking through a visor at 3D stuff.
Yeah.
Now I feel like I'm actually in space, and it works so well, even with only two sensors. And I'm told the best way to go is to get three and surround yourself with it, but I was able to just set them up. And I don't have very much space, so like this is the best I could do, and I'll just show you the space I had set out was just over here.
Sorry, audio-only listeners today. You're missing out.
You can see my gold shoes on the floor, but...
That's great.
I have this, like, 3x3 foot space to the side of my bed, and I put one of the sensors on my chair, I put the other one over there on this piece of wood, face them over there, and then I just got lost in VR land.
That's awesome.
And it's so immersive that in about an hour of being in Job Sim, I take the thing off, and I'm like, what part of my room am I in right now?
Yep.
Like, I actually have to get reacclimated to what I'm standing in.
Yeah!
Got you, motherfucker.
But the degree of detail and what really sold me, what was really impressive to me, is that you can literally juggle. Like, it's actually mapped so well. You could grab a thing in 3D space, toss it up in the air, and catch it with your other hand, and it feels like you're really doing it.
I remember talking about one of the videos that we saw advertising the Vive, where one of the guys that had the headset on caught one of the wands while it was thrown to him. Like, that's still one of the most impressive things to me, because that tracking is so good. It's unreal.
And there's actually sensors on the touch controller where it'll basically just know if your thumb is in this position or these positions, and it'll show you that in the actual game. So you're looking down at your real hand being mimicked by what you're doing in reality. It also has like a billion degrees of precision on the triggers too, and you can see how much it's depressed as you start to press it if you're looking at the thing in the headset. Yeah. Which is just, it's wild to think that like it's mapping this thing you're really doing, but it's doing it a one-to-one degree at 60 frames per second, and it feels as natural as anything.
Totally.
I even had my mom play with it, and she was able to shoot guns at targets accurately in like 5 seconds. It was like no big deal. So, I mean, that says something. It's that accessible that someone could just pick this up, never having played with VR before, and just immediately hit targets.
Especially consider like the difference between that and trying to teach your mom how to use a controller to shoot a gun.
Yeah. I had her try to play Isaac, actually. I have a video on my YouTube channel of her playing Isaac, and she couldn't like last for more than a room because it's so hard to understand what to do with your thumbs. If you're not familiar with like this moves and this shoots, like that's a bit of a more difficult thing to get over than my hand grabs things and tosses them with reality and physics.
Exactly, yeah.
You just know what to do with that.
I love being able, when people come over to try the VR too, I love being able, instead of having to be like, okay, you use WASD to move around, you use this key to interact, you use bullshit like this. It's like, okay, physically move that way. Like, move your hand up. That's the instructions. That's what they need to do. I love that.
I was also really having fun with that. I got a ping pong game too, and the fact that you can actually play ping pong with real people, like, that's so wild!
I'm so glad you're feeling these feelings, man, because there's nothing else like it of just, okay, you understand it now. You get it.
Yeah. Yeah, I really didn't get it before, and now I get it. Yeah. Playing dodgeball with, like, a set of three other people and tossing and catching balls, and it's bizarre. It feels like you're in the future.
Yes.
So I'm with Bear now. I've gone into the Rift as well, or into the Vive, I guess. You can just call it a Vive now.
We'll assimilate you all one in the
one. One in the same now. Mm-hmm. So consider this my ringing endorsement. If you're someone who ended up with an Oculus, you should probably get the touch controllers. I know they're expensive, but you'll definitely appreciate it. I think it's going to add drastically to the thing. And there's going to be a lot more to do with it coming up. Now that there's people making homebrew stuff trying to copy the same files that can go with the Vive, so you could be able to play both. The same way that the Vive could play all the Oculus stuff, eventually the Oculus will be able to play all the Vive stuff. And Job Simulator was one of those that recently made that transition, and it works perfectly. Mm-hmm. No criticism about the accuracy of the controls. Feels perfect.
Hell yeah. That is exciting. I really am like genuinely super happy for you that the Oculus is no longer more or less a failed purchase, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really feel like I need to get a Vive anymore, and I don't know that I even necessarily need to get a second gen anything for a bit. Mm-hmm. It actually, like, the only thing I'd really want to improve now is just higher resolution, like DPI in the headset, because it still looks grainy as hell, but it functions great, and you can still get lost in it now, even with the grainier visuals, so it'll only get better.
I'm 100% serious when I say once we have, like, that 4K lightweight headset, I'm gone.
Yeah.
I'm gone. See you guys later. I'm just going to spend my life in there.
I'll be there too. We've already halfway lost you at this point. There's a little bit of a push and you're gone forever. Yeah. You're just going to be sitting there playing games. Ali's going to have to come in and like feed you. Bear, it's time for dinner.
No, so just change the IV bag, man. Just change the IV bag. When this all comes to be, we'll just set up like a Minecraft town and you and me can live in VR.
Swear to God, we're joking right now, but 5 years down the road, there is going to be some sort of integration with what we do in VR. Like, that's going to be a thing. We're going to be hanging out with a bunch of Twitch chatters playing some bullshit game.
We're going to be able to fully pull out that four streamers live in the same house sitcom in VR.
Yeah.
There you go. That's what we've all desired the most, right? Is to live in a house together.
Don't put my name on the lease.
All right. We're running a little out of time here, so let's get quick into it. Afterbirth Plus. It is here.
Yeah.
Ryan, you want to take the wheel?
Yeah. Afterbirth Plus is a first party DLC for Isaac instead of, you know, a user-created mod. And it features a supply of new items as well as a harder variant of greed mode, as well as a new alternate win condition that gives you another floor and another final boss to fight, new enemies, and a new character as well. At the present moment, I would say it's fair to say that reception to Afterbirth Plus is mixed. People are largely happy with the new character, happy with the new items. I would say most people are into the new items. Displeased with some of the ways that launch has been handled, some technical issues, final boss not having any animations, and greedier mode, and some other areas of the game being imbalanced in such a way that it's unfair as opposed to simply being more difficult and also mimic chess, which are stupid.
Oh, fuck those things.
I hate them.
They nerfed Void last night.
How so?
It won't do Diplopia anymore more than once, and there's one other one-use item that it will only do like once.
Pandora's Box, probably?
Yeah, that's the other one. Yep. Yeah.
That makes sense, and that's a bummer, but yeah. It's still useful. But
I think I sit with most of the people where I feel like I'm very lukewarm on it so far. I agree. I like the new character. I really like his face bar item. I think it's really unique. I think it's a cool idea. I think most of the new items that I've come across so far are really cool. But it feels similar with Afterbirth in that the way that they implement, like, players want it to be more difficult. And for some reason, the development team thinks more difficult means unfair. And that was a little prevalent in Afterbirth, and it's now even more prevalent in Afterbirth Plus. And it's interesting looking at something like Antibirth, which had just come out, a couple weeks ago before Afterbirth Plus, and the way they balanced it and made it more difficult. And Antibirth, there are still some bullshit rooms in Antibirth, and there's still some design flaws that I don't particularly enjoy, particularly those damn fucking fireflies that circle you. I hate them. But Antibirth just feels like they balanced it properly. Like, there's a proper curve as you go through the floors in the new floors, in that the downpour feels like what the flooded caves should have been. Flooded caves was such a spike in Afterbirth, but downpour is more difficult, but it's fair. In Afterbirth and Afterbirth Plus, just feels like, you want more difficult? Then I'm going to ram my fist up your ass, and you're just going to have to deal with it and hope that you can, you know, you react in time. That's kind of how I feel like Afterbirth Plus went so far. And Antibirth did it right. And I hate saying that, because I was hoping Afterbirth Plus was going to do something like Antibirth did, but it didn't.
I'm not really super against it, aside from the biggest problem I have is the greedier mode is just kind of awful right now. I don't really want to play it at all. But I'm fine with the new items. They seem cool. More Isaac is always a good thing, in my opinion. And whether that comes in the form of Antibirth, Afterbirth Plus, mods, like, I'm down for all of it. The biggest thing I think they dropped the ball on, though, is the modding tools being really not very well implemented. Being that this is essentially what you're buying, right? Like, the additional items and floor are kind of, and character, are just sort of like gravy on top. The main point was, I think, to implement modding in a much more accessible way. And from what I've heard and from what I've seen firsthand, it's not really more than what the community's already made a year ago. And maybe Ryan can speak to that a bit better than I can regarding how some of that stuff was implemented, if he feels like it.
Yeah, I mean, I am a little ignorant to some extent about how it works, but I have seen that they're working on implementing the modding more to a larger extent. And just like as an aside, that's fine, but like, if the release is going to be rushed and, you know, there's bugs like, hey, this room has twice as many enemies in it than it should, and it's like, the Blastus room is almost literally like a run ender when it shows up. And, like, sure, it's a bug, but it's not a bug on the level of, like, hey, your doors are in wrong positions. It's a bug on the level of, like, your run is over. And, you know, the final boss not having any animation, you know? Like, this is the kind of stuff where you're like, well, if that isn't in there and the modding system isn't implemented fully the way that you want it to be implemented, why don't you just take like more time? Like, I get that you're under pressure as well and you want to get it out, but it sends the wrong message to be like, you know, we're going to release this on January 3rd. And then like 4 hours later, they're like, okay, now it's actually out, but there's like a bunch of bugs.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't ready. Yeah.
To some extent, I have sympathy for bugs for sure. I don't have much sympathy for, like, the boss not having an animation. I mean, in the end, it's not that big of a deal, but it's kind of like, how does that make it in? Like, that's one of the things you didn't notice. But either way. The way that the modding, there's two different ways you can do it. You can do it via Lua scripting, or you can go into the XML file that contains the properties and parameters for the items, and you can adjust those manually. And I do think that it's kind of a little ramshackle that they're like, oh, if you want a mod, we've exposed that stuff in the XML file, when it seems like it really should just be an interface that you can load up in the game and then be like, here's all the items, here's like the parameter that you can use to adjust them, and like Like, to have some in-game way to do that instead.
Yes, that's fully what I was expecting, yeah.
Which is what... compile button, and it puts it on the workshop, right? Like, that's what I wanted.
Yeah.
The analog that I make is being like, hey, you know, we don't have an options menu in our game, but we don't need one because you can just go into the INI file and you could be like, you know, put master volume. If a game's too loud, just type 50 instead of 100. For resolution, you know, just type 1280 by 720 and then like that'll do it. So it really seems like...
That's the worst kind of correct is the technically correct.
Yeah. Well, like it may have actually been a lot of work to get it to that point, but it's kind of irrelevant for the average end user who is going to be like, well, this is like, this still might as well be witchcraft to me, and it's not user friendly. So,
yeah.
I would have hoped for a bridge between the intermediate and the less experienced user. And even if that just comes in the form of, hey, you can make new Isaac characters with the stuff we've provided for you already. Right. Exactly. So, like, you know how Eden has a million different haircuts? Well, you can make a character and then pick what items they start with. And here, you can pick out of these, there's 20 attribute points. Brimstone takes 18, and then you can give them, like, one other little stat up or something. Let you play with that and then share it with your friends, and then it becomes a bit more like a community-oriented modding scene. I mean, I know it's not really modding in the same way, but it at least gives users something to do that is beyond what the scope of the actual game was.
Yeah.
As it is now, it's explicitly you need full-on programming knowledge until the community starts putting together tools that are going to act as that bridge. And they will eventually do it, I'm fairly certain. Whether it's to the point of what I'm talking about, oh, I kind of doubt, but I can only hope.
I was personally excited to play Anti-Birth within Afterbirth Plus. That was something I had anticipated was going to be made available fairly soon. Probably not immediately, but, you know, like within a month probably. But I guess that's almost certainly not going to happen now, is what I've
heard. They've walked that back a little bit. I mean, I don't expect it to be ready right away. Like, apparently the way that it, they basically on the Anti-Birth team made custom tools, or at least, you know, took advantage of other tools in order to make Anti-Birth. So it makes sense that, you know, that's not just something you can be like, you know, file, open my Anti-Birth code, and now it works. Like that, I understand that it's going to be like a lot of work to get that implemented into Afterbirth Plus, but there was like, you know, it's probably not even worth bringing up, but the Anti-Birth developer was like, here's some stuff that I'm not really thrilled with Afterbirth Plus, and then drama, 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 and then it's been walked back, and everybody's like, okay, we're cool with each other again, we're going to try to make it work. But apparently the impasse that it's at right now is that in order to implement Anti-Birth to their standards that they would like to, they need kind of access to the Isaac code, and Nicholas is like, we don't really want to give you that, and I can understand why they wouldn't want to give them decompiled source code because, you know, I mean, it could be used to make a better Isaac. not to say that the current Isaac situation is bad, but like they're giving the tools to somebody who could really maybe even take it to a further level. But hopefully it will get to the point where they can get the content into Afterbirth Plus. And I have faith that it could. I have no technical knowledge for why it would be plausible, but I assume that they're smart people and can make it happen. Mm-hmm.
Do you think it's unreasonable? What I was asking, because chat was saying, many different people in chat were saying modding should be for coders only. And I was thinking, well, what about like Duck Game? I can make levels and upload them really easily, and it doesn't really require much.
Why should modding be coders only? That seems...
You can have both options. Why can't you just have both options? You can just... If you want to do the coding aspect, that aspect is open to you. But if you just want to make cool stuff, you can just have the casual aspect open to you.
Well, like, I think that modding to the extent of, like, I don't know, like programming a new item, I don't think there's any way to make that, and no meaningful way that I can think of to make that accessible to people who can't code. Like, you're gonna, like,
and I'm fine with that. That's fine. That's beyond the scope. I'm talking about stuff that can be within the reach of people to do, such as modify stats, make that user friendly.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. That if all you want to do is like take a spacebar item and raise or lower the amount of rooms to get a charge, if literally all that you have to do is go to the XML code and change, you know, a 3 to a 6 or a 6 to a 3, I'm surprised actually that was not implemented in like a little bit more of a plain text user friendly way within the Isaac interface itself.
And now everyone's saying that's not modding. I mean, I made levels for Unreal Tournament. That was modding back then.
They're just
is that not modding now?
Chat's just being pedantic. It's just different levels of modding. It is just what are you looking to like go deep into the code and do your own thing? There's no reason why you can't just do both.
I mean, I added texture. I made a total conversion for Marathon when I was like 13. That was modding.
It was not modding anymore, man. You're not as hardcore as you need to be.
Think you've it's met involved these the
level
standards.
Editor, yes, but I also changed textures. I also changed animations. That's a whole different thing. I understand. Mm-hmm. Whatever.
Everybody's being pedantic.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
stuff. I don't think Nicholas needs to put a character creator in the game. But if there was a way for a character creator of that style to be modded into the game, I think that that's acceptable, and you know that's all that is required in order to get that done. Mm-hmm. But like, I mean, I'm just really surprised that like. It's mod friendly, at least in its present state, is really just like, here's the file. Like you can change the file. That's like to put that as such an important part of the release. And really that's where the hope for the Isaac community lies, is that it's going to like, that's going to allow them to implement new content into the game. You know,
this was supposed to be like the effect of handing over the reins, wasn't it?
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
I think those same words were actually used specifically.
Hmm.
Like, it's very aspirational. And then the fact that the codes are kind of half-baked right now, not the code, sorry, the implementation is kind of half-baked right now is, it's not frustrating for me because I'll just wait, but it is, I guess, a little worrying. And I think it's just, I mean, I don't want to throw any shade at the publishers or at Edmund for that matter, but like, It really feels like the release was kind of like half-baked. Yeah. And it felt like that, especially on Tuesday. Like on Tuesday, when you're like, well, the game is supposed to be up at like noon, and then at 4, they're like, we're uploading the achievements now, which means we're almost ready to release the game.
And like at 4, we're all playing Rocket League while listening to Ocean Man. Yeah.
Right. I feel like just before I get like distracted here, like there is a disconnect from why people like Isaac and why like the publisher feels that. Be like Isaac. And Greedier Mode is at like the core of that. Greedier Mode like embodies the completely opposite way of why most people like Isaac, I think. But from a publisher standpoint, I have some sympathy because you're like, or a developer standpoint even, you're like, well, everyone's complaining because Isaac's too easy. People are going on like 100, 200,000 win streaks. Like the game's too easy, so we got to make it harder. And then they double the amount of enemies and lower the charge time and give you less money and make more champion spawn. And then people go, not like that. Like, what are you doing? And they're like, I don't understand like what you want. But
that's why I point to Antibirth. I really think Antibirth hit that balancing factor really, really well.
I agree. Like I feel like from a developmental or design standpoint, they know what people want out of Isaac. I don't even think they know. I know they know.
Yeah.
Whereas like, and you're like, the game's, this is entitled to some extent, but you're like, the game's 4 hours late, and it's 4 hours late because you didn't want to upload the achievements to Steam because it's going to spoil it for people. Nobody cares. Like yeah. A small percentage of people care. They're like, oh, look at this picture. It's, you know, Isaac's foreskin and, you know, oh, how does that fit into the lore? Sure. Like people just want to play the game. They're going to play 100 hours, not to get the new ending, but because they like the mechanics of the game and it gets like, you know, the emerging gameplay of like, I've never had these two items come together before. And then they interact in unique ways. So like, it's just like a little bit of, like this is not understanding, I think, what people like about Isaac and what has kept Isaac going for like so long.
Yeah.
That being said, I still think Afterbirth Plus is going to be fine. And
yeah,
I'm like pro Afterbirth Plus relative to the community. I like the new items and that's going to stay. Sure. Okay. Pandora's Box and Diplopia. I that's kind of like a read the room situation. Like people are mad about stuff. Don't take away fun overpowered stuff yet. You know, like take it. Nobody cares. Everybody wants to get Diplopia in Pandora's Box and then break the run and then it's good, right? But
yeah.
It's
I just wish I could take aspects of Afterbirth and Afterbirth Plus and aspects of Antibirth and just put them together, because I think in there's a perfect Isaac experience. There's aspects of Antibirth I don't like some of the synergies from Afterbirth I miss, and like some of the synergies don't work like I would want them to in Antibirth. But Antibirth introduces, like I said before, that really good difficulty curve, but they also introduce more choice in that you can still go these alternate routes, but you can pick and choose when you want to go to them. Oh, maybe I'm not powerful enough now. Maybe I'll try and tackle the mines for mines 2 instead of mines 1, and you can kind of go these zigzag routes and do different things. And if you don't get powerful enough, you can still beat the game by doing the normal chest runs. Like, there's just that choice is there, and you can balance the difficulty in your own mind. Like, okay, my run's powerful enough for doing this, but not that, or I can definitely go this route, but I can't do that. That's what I really wanted out of Afterbirth and Afterbirth Plus. But we got hell portals that spawn haunts on the cathedral, like over and over again, and like this weird, like kick you in the balls difficulty. It's unfortunate. It's weird that Antibirth came out so close to Afterbirth Plus too, because I do think that tainted Afterbirth Plus release a little bit.
We've said this in a number of ways, but Antibirth's release really did throw a stick in the cog, didn't it?
But they wanted to release it ahead. They released it unfinished to be in front of Afterbirth Plus.
Yeah. Well, if you release a huge mod after Afterbirth Plus comes out, half of the conversation is going to be, why didn't you just make this a mod in Afterbirth Plus?
That's true.
I think.
Yeah,
exactly.
As time goes on, I have more sympathy for that, because they're like, you know, we spent 2 years making this mod at great personal expense, and we want to make sure it gets some attention. And it got attention not because it was like the only mod on the scene, but because the mod was really good.
Right.
So yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that the story about that is about the quality of the mod, as opposed to just being like, well, why is I'll play it when they get in, get it implemented in Afterbirth Plus.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Aside from like the crashing, I'd say that Antibirth is basically at commercial quality. Like, it is on parity with the game itself. Right.
I agree.
Yeah.
That's
in a way
incredible.
That blows things up for Nicholas, because like, that shouldn't be free. The only reason it's free is because, you know, they don't own the property. So like that's like a commercial level release for free. And people have been using that against Afterbirth Plus in a way that I feel is a little unfair.
Yeah, I agree.
They're like, well, you know, Antibirth is free and it's awesome. Why is your expansion, you know, $7 and not as good? Like, well,
yeah, I don't mean it in a punitive way. I honestly just mean it as a bit of praise toward the modders, because it's just that good.
Yeah, that's how I
shouldn't be used against them, though.
Mm-hmm. Sweet. Afterbirth Plus. We'll probably talk about
it. Just because, like, it's like your dad buying you lunch. And you're like, you know, why am I paying $5 for this shitty sandwich? My dad bought me a steak yesterday. You know, like, that you shouldn't, at that birth, you should be extremely grateful that that's free, because, like, so much work and money went into it. Like, Kilburn was like, I paid $4,000 out of my own pocket to, like, get the soundtrack done. And I don't know if he was paying for art as well, but, like, so much time and then also, like, a lot of money, and then it's basically a gift from them to you, the community. So at least just like, don't hold that against the people who need to sell copies of the game to like justify their work and existence.
That's a great analogy. Apart from Afterbirth Plus being referred to as a shitty sandwich within it, I think that might be selling it a little short.
I hope that we, you know, in like a month or 6 months, we'll look back and be like, well, Afterbirth Plus was a little weird at launch, but at least it enabled people to get more content into the game eventually, and now Isaac with Afterbirth Plus is like the way to play Isaac.
Yeah,
that would be cool.
Yeah, right on.
Yeah, I don't think any of us really hated it. I think we had a rough launch, is what it was.
This
ultimately,
is very,
it'll sort
very
itself
valid
out.
Concerns. I think we've all got too, honestly.
And you're more passionate about the things that you play constantly, right? So exactly. If anyone's going to have a lot of criticism, it'll probably be us.
Mm-hmm. It'll be the people who played it for hundreds of hours.
Yep.
Greed mode or greedier mode needs to be fixed.
It does, so. Yeah. I've only played like 3 runs of it and it was miserable.
It's the worst. Why would you ever? I mean, I get the other thing that Ed said was like, hey, we shouldn't test next time with 2 experienced testers. I understand that. That's an easy pitfall to fall into. But greedier mode is like, you made like so many mistakes. Hey, greed mode's too easy. What should we do? Why don't we limit the amount of resources, make it literally impossible to kill all the enemies, make it so you have to buy HP, make the enemies harder, make them spawn faster, and you're like, it's...
No, man, like, for original greed mode, I don't even think the argument, at least for me, it wasn't that it was too easy. Sure, it was easy, but Isaac can get easy if you just know what you're doing.
Yeah.
The problem with greed mode is there was just no reason to go play it again.
I never felt like Isaac was too easy. I mean, you guys have hundreds, thousands of hours. Like, I'm not the most experienced of the group, but I've never felt that way. I've gotten a suitable challenge out of it.
Eventually, you just become comfortable with this flowchart, as Ryan always says, that there's just proper, like, good measures that you take in certain situations. Mm-hmm. And I think once you distill that down to being a formula, it's less about playing the game than it is just about making the right decision.
Yeah, okay.
And that's when I think it gets easy. I don't mean to say that I'm on that level, but I think I have moments of seeing that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. We'll probably talk about it more as it develops, but that is Afterbirth Plus for now. And now it's time for everybody's favorite segment. It's Ask Roundtable. Ask Roundtable is the weekly segment where you send your questions to roundtableyt@gmail.com. We do our best to answer them. This week's question comes from a viewer from Greece, Zacharias. That's a cool-ass name, Zacharias. Thank you for the question. Says, which game was the most challenging intellectually for you guys? The game that made your brain juice boil. Do you like it or not, and why? Challenging intellectually. Anybody got one?
For me, the original one was probably, like, Space Cam. Like, that game had a lot of, like, every subsequent level was, like looking at a mountain. And then eventually, you know, you just, like, fail at climbing it over and over and over and over and over. And then you get it, and then the next one is another mountain. Like, it just keeps getting higher. You like it for, like, or I liked it for, like, brief moments. The sense of satisfaction of, like, getting a level done is amazing. Then there's a lot of times where you're like, I just spent 45 minutes doing, like, I thought, I was like, oh, I got it. And then I build the reactor, and then I look at it and I go, it's the same fucking reactor I built that didn't work like an hour ago. And then I'm just like, I think those games you need to play like in short bursts kind of, or if not in short bursts, at least you have to play them with a different kind of mindset that there's like, there's not instant gratification. And it's more like, you know, the struggle is part of the fun.
Top review on Space Cam is, am I a scientist now or something? With 5 hours yeah. played?
I mean, can I have my degree, please?
That game is hard, man.
Any Zachtronics game, I'm sure, is going to get up there.
I don't know.
I got to tell you, man, I make a point of it not to play games like this. I'm too dumb, and I know it. I embrace that in my gaming experience. I'm looking for the dumb shit, the beat-em-ups. The
1001 Spikes, that's yours,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly. No, I'm saying, like, Dynasty Warriors level. That's where I get the most dopamine release, but I'm trying to think of, like, what the smartest game I've ever played was, but there really aren't that many good
You should
examples.
Really play, like, Dragon Ball Xenoverse 2, then. Because that, yeah. If we're, like, on the polar opposite of games, mm-hmm. that was a game where, like, you press X and your dude goes, like, Yu-Gi-Oh! Taki Wokorau! And, like, shoots down a big, like, laser beam. Yeah. It's, like, a 9 million hit combo. Yeah. And I was like, this is stupid. I just pressed X, and he's hey, like, I don't deserve that for pressing X.
It should be, like, it's actually really good. All right.
Should be like a quarter circle and then an X.
Pressing
or something.
X should give me one notch of completion. That's all I expect. Yeah.
I think the game I'm playing right now that's like teasing my brain, and not like a puzzle game sort of way, but just making me think, mm-hmm. is I'm playing Orwell. I'm playing through Orwell right now.
Yeah.
That game completely caught me off guard. Like, I knew what the themes were, obviously by the name. And what the idea is, but in case you don't know what it is, it takes place in this kind of, I struggle to use the word dystopian future. There's a new program out. It's called Orwell. They pick anonymous civilians to monitor like the other civilians through CCTV cameras and stuff. And your job is to try and catch crimes like before they happen and monitor people of special interest. And it gets really dark really quickly. And you kind of start questioning like, are you doing what's right? Are you doing what's wrong? I don't want to spoil what has happened so far, but I'm not done with the game yet either. But it's incredibly good.
Mm-hmm.
It makes you think, and I haven't had a game do that for me in a long time.
Cool.
But yeah, Orwellian future. That's what you call it, I guess. Yeah.
That makes sense, right?
Yeah, that makes sense.
For me, do you want to go, Bear?
I found one. And
yeah, go for it.
The one that made me feel the most intellectually stimulated was probably Myst way back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
That was I played that with my dad quite a bit, and he would help me out. But it was, that one introduced me to going outside of the box more or less, because you know I played a lot of games that were just like, here you go, here's what you do. Let's hold your hand and follow along the linear storyline. But Myst was like, figure it out. Here's this world. You have no idea what's going on, especially as a kid. I'm like, dude, if you don't tell me what to do, I don't know what to do. I'm just kind of clicking shit. But once I got a little bit of guidance and direction, it was actually really enjoyable. But I do also have the other side of that, which was The Witness, which as a grown-ass man, I don't have my dad to hold my hand for anymore. Although I did, I think I told you guys this actually. I had my dad over last year, and he got totally into The Witness. He was playing it for hours. He loved it, but I did not. I don't like The Witness at all.
For me, I'd say actually I was going to mirror the same sentiment that The Witness was probably the obvious choice. Mm-hmm. But then I was thinking about it more with what we were just talking about a moment ago. And I think the same element and the other side of that same coin is that in a way Isaac follows a lot of that same formula in that you're learning a language in sort of this dexterity-driven puzzle where the right and wrong choices come down to you knowing what each item means and what that translates to in the game. Mm-hmm. So it's a long-form puzzle that you put together through hundreds of little tiny bits and pieces of Twin Stick Shooter, which in a way makes it almost a lot more accessible than The Witness does because you have so much more hands-on experience with every little bit and iteration of the gears in that machine, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
The Witness obviously is the much more contemplative version of that where you can take your time and think about every action you make. But Isaac is like you're sprinting through the puzzle. And I think there's something cool about both sides of that same coin. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I love both of them for those reasons. And, you know, whether you think Isaac is more a dexterity-driven game, I think there's an argument to be made that it's also partially a puzzle game, too.
Cool.
Baird, quick question. Did you play Abduction?
No, I haven't yet. I need to. That's on my short list, too. Yeah. I played the VR version of that at PAX, though, which was
nice.
Really cool.
It's a bit obtuse, even for a missed game, I think, sometimes.
Really? Hmm. Okay.
It's good, though.
Yeah. Great. Okay. Thank you very much, Zacharias. And if you've got a question you'd like to ask us, get some 2017 batch of questions in, huh? Would you do that? RoundtableYT@gmail.com is where you want to send those. Time for everybody's favorite segment after their favorite segment, Nick's Weird Games. Nick's Weird Games is the weekly wherein Nick's going to go get a game from his collection of not as many weird games anymore, right? We're running a little low on the Nick's Weird Games.
We're running a bit low. We might be thinking about drafting a new segment soon. We'll see.
So we'll see how that goes. For now, though, I do have a very special request. I'm going to have to hear a rendition of Ween's Ocean Man.
How appropriate.
Dude, for some reason, like, I can't keep the tune of that in my head. Like, I know it goes, Ocean Man, take me by the hand, leave me to it. I gotta, like, put it up here so I can hear it first.
Sure. I can almost sing it verbatim.
Such a good song.
It's beautiful. I didn't know that was from the SpongeBob fucking SquarePants movie. That made me really happy to find out.
Oh, I didn't know that either.
Yeah.
That's bizarre.
Take me by the hand.
That'd be like a... Ah, jeez. Yeah, okay. Weird game man, take a game by the hand. It is from Japan for the PlayStation. Weird game man, publisher defunct since the year was 2006. I mean, it's
try.
There's a rhyme in here somewhere in there.
I tried.
First verse is great.
Thanks, appreciate it. It fell apart. Like, it's a very unusual song.
It is. It yeah, is. The rhythm is interesting.
Yeah, it keeps you off balance.
Beautiful though.
It doesn't really conform to the typical lyrical flow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's tough.
I'm glad we got a challenge for you at the onset of 2017. Nick's Weird Games, let's do it.
Thanks. Turn on the right foot. So everybody close your chats. Mm-hmm. If you don't mind. Let's see. I didn't realize I closed my browser at one point, so I have to pull up the information again. Okay. Today's game is a graphical adventure game published by Dreamcatcher Interactive. Came out in the year 2000. This is a PC game. Came out on Windows 95 and 98 and Mac OS.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Here we go.
Single player only. Mm-hmm. Gameplay is similar to games in the genre such as Myst or Zork.
Oh, shit.
Okay.
Dreamcatcher Interactive.
Received good reviews from your standard adventure game sites such as Adventureland.
It's not Riven, is it?
Love that site.
No.
Okay.
The title sold over 500,000 copies and was PC Data's best-selling adventure game of 2000. It was Dreamcatcher's most successful title to date.
Wow.
To date.
That was very their first optimistic. Title. That was their last good game.
First title to break into big box retailers in the USA such as Target and Walmart.
It is the seventh guest.
No.
That was my answer.
13th hour.
No. I think those are all before 2000, if I know correctly. I think
the seventh guest was like 95
ish.
The 11th hour.
Well, let me give you a little bit of flavor on the story, because I think that'll be what sets it apart.
Okay.
So the storyline is set in the future, where the protagonist is sent to another planet to investigate the source of a cryptic message from an evil alien race. The player begins to have...
Oh, I know this game.
Yeah?
I'm so excited. Shit.
I'm so excited.
Crystal Key!
Yeah, yes! Bear got it!
Damn, son.
Woo! I did it!
17, boys, everything's changing.
Crystal Key, that's similar to Myst, man. Oh, hell yeah. Okay, I remember that.
I can't believe you've done this.
No, I didn't actually play this, but I saw my friend play this. This was a, oh man, that's old school.
Crystal Key.
Begin your quest for the Crystal Key.
Damn, son. That sold 500,000 copies? Damn.
That was quite popular.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it did so well, but congratulations, Bear.
Awesome.
Maybe one of your first.
I think I remember distinctly. You remember when Dan did his Dan's Weird Games?
Yeah.
I guess the Ed, Ed, and Eddie game. I think that might be the only other one I've gotten. So <right now. laughs>
In chat, I see someone named Try Strange might be the first person who named it. So congratulations to you for knowing your adventure games.
These guys made Painkiller, and
what else
Crystal Key is their most successful game of all time.
They fly under the radar, I think.
Yo, but Painkiller, though. Painkiller's got like 12 sequels.
I think it's like a niche game, though. Even though it's popular, I think it's popular in like a niche. Like, because it's a hardcore kind of like Quake-esque first-person shooter, and I don't know if there's as big a following for that anymore. I hear you, though. It seems like obviously that would be more popular.
I would eat my fucking dick if the Crystal Key has sold more copies than Painkiller.
I would say it was their best-selling to date of 2000, so...
I refuse to believe this.
Painkiller units
sold. Just get the metrics on Painkiller, then.
This is very important now.
My dick.
I don't got any figures, man. We're gonna have to confirm this later.
You have to talk to like the publisher or something.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, wasn't Painkiller People That Fly? I could have sworn it was.
Yep, People Can Fly. Developer.
Oh, you're just talking about the publisher. Sorry.
Oh yeah, no, it was published by Dreamcatcher. Yep.
Yeah, developed by Earthlight Productions.
Did it say? You know, it's getting a little semantic, but.
Wait, what?
Oh, they're Canadian.
Oh, good. We'll keep that in your mind for the rest of your life.
Well, Dreamcatcher is best known for publishing Painkiller.
Okay.
Painkiller became a commercial success and was signed with the CPL World Tour 2005, which of course we're all aware of.
Sure.
They also created another label, Silverline Software. Sure, okay, whatever. Like, how many copies did it sell?
How many copies did Painkiller sell? Clearly is what we're looking for here. You find out.
Probably tweet their studio. Maybe they'll tell us.
They're still around, aren't they? They're still pumping stuff.
I think so.
My friend's got to eat his dick if Painkiller sold less copies than the Crystal Key.
Yeah, you could get a response with that. Absolutely. Send somebody an email. They'll let you know.
Steam charts, Painkiller. That's not even going to be a good indicator.
You're looking, I am going to say thank you all very much for watching our first episode of 2017 Roundtable Live. Really appreciate it. We'll be back to this scheduled time here on Fridays, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern. This is our old stomping grounds. We don't plan on moving it again in the foreseeable future. You can catch the show VOD over on our YouTube channels, youtube.com/BearTaffyMath, his games, Rockley Smile. Not to put you on the spot, but are you planning on uploading them still, right?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Okay, cool. Northern Lion as well. The Twitch VOD, I want to address this out of the gate. The Twitch VOD is now behind the subscriber paywall. This is actually something I was intending to do from the beginning, but never did. But now that is the case. We have quite a few subscribers on the channel now. I really want to say thank you to the people that have been showing support that way as well. That is awesome. We're like nearly at 100 subs on the Roundtable podcast channel, which is really cool.
Guys.
So thank you very much. That's awesome. We also want to thank our Patreon supporters on patreon.com/roundtable who have been there for nearly 2 years now, starting up there with Julian Avelsgard, General Crunk, Jonathan, Johnny Whoops, Graham, Scrotty119, Farron Knox, new patron there. Thank you, buddy. Talks to Wall, Trevor Farley, Chaos, Lean Mean Meme Machine Theorist. You are the unsung hero of my Patreon reads, buddy. Colby Klein, Greenlight, Warren Saltzman, Christopher Flagg, Eric Schooley, Brizzle Britt, Positron, Mythscare, Mediocrities, Justin Somerfett, and Logan Ray. Thank you all very much for your continued support over there on patreon.com/roundtable. Tweet us with games you'd like us to cover on the show at RoundtablePC. We'd appreciate some suggestions there. Looking to play quite a bit more games this week. Or not even this week, this year. And the show subreddit is roundtablepodcast.reddit.com. And that's it. You can watch the, or you can also download the MP3 over on SoundCloud, iTunes as well. There's all that stuff. Thank you very much for watching. We'll be back here live, twitch.tv/roundtablepodcast, next week at 3 p.m. Pacific. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
See you later, everybody.
Bye.